We have spent the past 7 years delving into the darkest depths of the world's most disturbing images, videos, and encounters. And we have seen some pretty strange stuff. But we hear you. 20-minute videos are not enough to quench the thirst of some of the hardcore viewers. So how about almost 4 hours of disturbing content? Well, that's what we have in store for you here. Now, you're going to want to hit the lights for this video. And before we begin, we'd like to say a huge thank you to Magellan TV for sponsoring this mammoth of a video. Now, if you're like us here at Top Fives, you've probably got a knack for documentaries and true crime programming outside of the confines of YouTube. There are so many untold stories out there waiting to be heard, but it's hard to know where to look sometimes. And a lot of times when you do find a trove of true crime content, it's filled with the same selection of case files you've seen over and over again. Luckily, there's a brand new resource for all things mystery and true crime television, where these worries do not exist: Magellan TV. Magellan TV is a fresh take on the membership-based streaming platform, created by a close-knit team of filmmakers who understand what real fans of true crime desire. They offer the most unique and deepest library of crime-related shows available at any single location on the web, and love to bridge multiple topics such as paranormal and extraterrestrial stories through the lens of true crime. And if true crime isn't your first cup of tea, they also withhold documentaries covering subjects such as science, nature, and outer space, with zero limits on imagination, across 3,000 titles. And the best part is, they add new shows and 24-hour ad-free content each week, so you can discover new interests at any given moment, on any device of your choosing. One especially intriguing title we have to recommend is The Last Confession of the Cannibal, a documentary diving into the story of infamous killer Alexander Pierce as he awaited execution. It's the perfect blend of mystery and real-life horror, and a must-watch for fans of our Murderous Minds series. If you sign up today, you'll receive a free 1-month trial by clicking on the link in the description below. So stop waiting and discover those untold stories guaranteed to capture your imagination. And now, if you haven't already done so, hit those lights, sit back, and enjoy. Attempted murder turned meme. This next one is an ongoing saga of misguided heroism, in which a young woman who tries to brutally murder her boyfriend gains a cult following amongst the Japanese meme community. It all began on May 23, 2019, when 21-year-old Yuka Takaoka was arrested for brutally stabbing her boyfriend, 20-year-old Phoenix Luna. The gruesome photos that were released in the aftermath showed Yuka sitting in the lobby next to her horribly wounded lover, completely drenched in his blood, casually smoking and talking on her mobile phone to an unknown person. The photograph soon went viral, but instead of people being repulsed by the image, the online anime community in Japan sanctified Yuka as the manifestation of a real-life yandere, a character from the world of anime. Such a character, typically female, turns to homicidal violence in the pursuit of love. Since the attack, dozens of Instagram accounts have sprung up in support of Yuka, and her besotted supporters claim she is too beautiful to be an attempted murder suspect. A donation page was even set up to support Yuka that raised over $3,000. Yuka and Phoenix both worked in hostess clubs in the Kabukicho district in Shinjuku, Tokyo. Yuka was a manager of a so-called girls bar, and Phoenix was a bar host at Fusion Nightclub. Hostess clubs are famous in the nightlife industry of East Asian countries, where male and female hosts are paid to keep guests company and entertain them. Yuka and Luna had recently started dating, but Yuka had grown increasingly jealous of the female attention her boyfriend received as a host. And when he arrived at her home late on May 23rd, and the couple had an argument about a photo of a woman Phoenix had on his phone, the couple went to bed, but Yuka waited for her boyfriend to fall asleep before viciously slicing open his stomach with a kitchen knife. Phoenix woke up terrified and managed to escape to the first floor lobby of the apartment block and call emergency services, and that is when the horrific photo was taken. Phoenix was later rushed unconscious to hospital. After the sick image started circulating and Yuka was arrested, media reports emerged stating that Yuka told investigators, "Since I loved him so much, I just couldn't help it. I was sad and seeking to die, and I thought about how I would like to go about it. I thought I would like to kill him because I thought that was how I could be with him. I thought that expressions such as, 'I like you, and I would like to be with you,' would become a reality if we both die. Fortunately, Phoenix survived the attack after initially only being given a 20% chance. And he popped up on Twitter on July 1st, 2019, tweeting, "Sorry guys, but I survived this one." Despite his trauma, Phoenix Luna showed no ill will towards Yuka and told reporters, "I don't hold a grudge. There was a reason for her to stab me. It was also thanks to her that I was able to achieve the sales I did in less than a year since returning as a host." Yuka has been charged with the attempted murder of Phoenix Luna and is currently in custody awaiting her court date. Meanwhile, her crime and misplaced admiration lives on in the form of the many memes and artwork created of her crime. The tragic story of the Donner Party. In the 1840s, the fertile farmlands of Central California drew a steady stream of settlers, and in the spring of 1846, several families from Springfield, Illinois, joined the westward migration. On April 14, 1846, after an emotional farewell, wealthy brothers George and Jacob Donner, along with local businessman James Reed and their families, left Springfield to make the long journey to a new life in the Bay of San Francisco. The group consisted of George and Jacob's combined 12 children, as well as Reed's 4 children and their respective wives. In addition, around a dozen teamsters and camp assistants joined them, making a total of 32. Everything the group needed to make the journey was packed, including peace offerings of jewelry and cloth should they encounter any hostile native Indians along the route. Within a month, the Donners and Reeds had reached Independence, Missouri. They were all healthy and in good spirits, and looked forward to joining the main wagon train heading west. After a brief stop, the group set off again, and over the next 6 weeks, covered around 650 miles, reaching Fort Laramie, now southeastern Wyoming, in July 1846. At this point, the group divided. Most of the wagons went north towards Fort Hall, using the tried and trusted Oregon Trail. But the Reeds, the Donners, and a number of others decided to take a shortcut and headed southwest toward Fort Bridger. This route had been recommended to them by an unreliable guide named Lansford Hastings. He had claimed that this route would shave more than 300 miles from the journey to California. In reality, Hastings' shortcut was 125 miles longer than the established trail, and it would take the pioneers through some of the most inhospitable county in the entire Great Basin. James Reed had been warned not to take this route, but he didn't heed this advice, and the party of 87 people pressed on in a convoy of 23 ox-drawn wagons. George Donner was elected to serve as their leader. On July 31st, the Donner Party entered Hastings Cutoff, which would take the group south of the Great Salt Lake in what is now Utah. During that first week, they made good progress. However, Hastings, who had promised to lead them along the trail, was now with a different company of wagons, and the inexperienced Reed had to act as a guide. By the time they reached the Great Salt Lake Desert on August 30th, they were already 2 weeks behind schedule. But Hastings had assured them that they would be able to cross the desert in just 2 days. But instead, the journey took 5 days, and the party lost dozens of cattle in the desert, and several wagons had to be abandoned. By the time the Donner Party reached the Humboldt River, where the shortcut rejoined the main California trail, it was late September. All the other migrants of 1846 had already completed their journeys to California, and for the Donner Party, it was now a race against time before the winter weather set in. The migrants were exhausted and tensions were running high. And on October 5th, an altercation between Reed and a teamster ended with Reed fatally stabbing the man. The horrified migrants called for Reed to be hanged, but instead they expelled him from the group, leaving him just with a horse. Reed continued his journey west alone, while the rest of his family remained with the Donner Party. As the party began their climb of the Sierra foothills, their food supply was running low, and several of their oxen were already dead or had wandered off. By this point, they had hidden or buried virtually all their possessions, except the barest essentials necessary for survival. On October 31st, the exhausted migrants approached what is now known as Donner Pass across the Sierra Nevada, and found their passage blocked by deepening snow. most of the party decided to build makeshift shelters near what is now known as Donner Lake. The Donners and Reeds, whose progress was delayed by a wagon accident, made a similar camp a few miles further east, on the trail near Alder Creek. By now, all the migrants were in dire trouble. On November 20th, 1846, Patrick Breen, whose family had joined the party in Independence, Missouri, began a diary, which he continued to write until March 1st, 1847. His account would provide the only contemporary written record of the Donner Party's ordeal. On December 15th, 1846, the first recorded death at the lake camp occurred, when Bayless Williams, an employee of the Reed family, died of malnutrition. His death was the first of many. In desperation, some of the migrants tried to branch off and walk to get help, but the conditions soon prevented this, and they returned to the camps even more malnourished than when they left. Things were so bad that the migrants were eating the oxhide that was providing their huts with warmth and shelter. Strips of the oxhide were boiled up to make a disgusting glue-like soup. Quarrels between the members were also rife, with some claiming rations that were being saved for the children. On December 16, 1846, a party of 17 men, women, and older children decided to try and cross the mountains on improvised snowshoes. Two of the party turned back early on, but the rest powered on. During the following torturous weeks, the group experienced snow blindness and overwhelming hardships caused by the bitter cold. However, the snowshoes proved to be effective on the climb, and despite the deep snow and inadequate food, they struggled on. But soon they became lost and confused, and that is when one of them first suggested that someone should volunteer to die to feed the others. Initially, this idea was rejected, but as they went on, and some of the party died anyway, in desperation, they were forced to eat the corpses to survive. Allegedly, towards the end, they were deciding amongst themselves who would be the next to be eaten, although it's unclear if any murders actually took place. Finally, the group stumbled into a Native American settlement where they were given food and shelter, and after a few days, with the help of tribe members, one of the party reached a ranch and a small farming community at the edge of the Sacramento Valley. A relief party was organized to rescue the stranded settlers at the lake camps. James Reed had also made it out of the Sierra Nevada and had already arranged an unsuccessful search party to try and rescue his family. Back at the camps, many migrants were dying of cold and hunger, and Jacob and George Donner were among them. After several rescue parties were sent out, some of the migrants made it back safely, but several deaths occurred on the way, and because of illness and injuries, it was impossible to remove everyone at the same time, and by the time the rescuers arrived, many of the lake camp members had already turned to cannibalism in order to survive. The last of the survivors did not leave the lake camp until April 1847. Of the 87 migrants in the river camps, only 48 survived. All of the Reed and Breen family lived, but Jacob and George Donner and their wives all perished. Some of their children survived, but were left orphaned. In the aftermath of the tragedy, with rumors of cannibalism rife, many of the survivors disputed the accounts, although some did speak freely about what they had to do to survive. Aliza Donner, who was only 3 years old during migration, and was the youngest of the Donner children, later published an account of the ordeal, and wrote about the emotional scars caused by the rumors of cannibalism. Many years later, in 2010, the remains from the campsite were examined again, and researchers announced that they had been unable to find any human bones or other physical evidence of cannibalism. Although it was noted that only cooked bones would be preserved, and it's unlikely that the Donner Party members would have needed to cook human bones. Today, the site of the makeshift cabins is a tourist attraction that receives thousands of visitors each year. The state of California justifies memorializing a site where cannibalism likely occurred, stating the episode was an isolated and tragic incident of American history that has been transformed into a major folk epic. Bella Elmore. Now, this next one is a bit of a blast from the past, but is a case we've never covered on Top 5s, so thought we would have a look, as there has been a recent twist in the story. Kunigunde Makomidze was the daughter of a Russian-Polish father and German mother. She went by various aliases, including Bella Elmore and Cora Turner. Bella was her stage name, however the aspiring music hall artist had little or no talent, so rarely found work. In 1893, under the name of Cora Turner, she married a homeopath and medicine dispenser, Hawley Harvey Crippen, in New Jersey City. Cora was Crippen's second wife. His first wife, Charlotte, had died of a stroke in 1892, and after her death, Crippen had moved to New York and left the care of his two-year-old son, Hawley Otto, to his parents in California. In 1897, Crippen and Cora moved to London, although his US medical qualifications were not sufficient to allow Crippen to practice as a doctor in the UK, so he found work as a distributor of patent medicines, while Cora continued to pursue her stage career. By all accounts, Cora was an overbearing woman who liked to socialize and had several affairs, but nevertheless, her husband tried to support her as much as he could, and eventually it cost him his job, as he was spending so much time trying to manage her career. In 1900, Crippen found work again as the manager of Drouet's Institution for the Deaf. By 1905, the Crippens' marriage was in trouble, and they moved to 39 Hilldrop Crescent in Holloway, London, where they took in lodgers to supplement Crippen's meagre income. Allegedly, Cora had an affair with one of these lodgers, and in turn, Crippen started an affair with Ethel Leneuve, a young typist who worked at Drouet's. For the next 5 years, the Crippens led separate lives and slept in separate beds. However, Cora still liked to throw dinner parties for her showbiz friends, and on the evening of Monday, the 31st of January 1910, two close friends of Cora, Paul and Clara Martinetti, came around for a meal. The couple left at around 1 a.m. on Tuesday the 1st of February, and all seemed well. That was the last time anyone saw Cora Crippen alive. Over the next few weeks, people began to ask where Cora was, and Crippen told a variety of stories about her whereabouts, but eventually said she had returned to America and died. Meanwhile, his lover moved into Hilldrop Crescent and began openly wearing Cora's clothes and jewelry. Cora's friends grew suspicious, and eventually one of them called the police. And on the 8th of July 1910, Chief Inspector Walter Drew knocked on the door of Hilldrop Crescent, where he found Ethel alone. Ethel told Drew he would find Crippen at work, so the inspector visited Crippen at his office, and the two returned together to Hilldrop Crescent, where Crippen happily showed the officer around the house. He also told Drew a different story about Cora's whereabouts, saying she had left him for another man. Chief Inspector Drew seemed happy with this explanation, and after a quick search of the house, left and asked Crippen to get his wife to contact him to confirm the story. However, Crippen and Ethel panicked and fled to Brussels, where they spent the night at a hotel before boarding the Canadian Pacific liner SS Montrose at Antwerp, bound for Canada. The pair's sudden departure prompted police to search the house in Hilldrop Crescent again, and during the fourth and final search, they found the torso of a human body buried under the brick floor of the basement. An autopsy confirmed traces of the calming drug, scopolamine, in the body parts, and the remains were identified by a scar on a piece of skin from the abdomen that matched with the medical procedure Cora had had, although her head, limbs, and skeleton were never recovered. Meanwhile, Crippen, who had shaved off his mustache and Ethel described as a boy, were crossing the Atlantic on Montrose, although passengers had noticed they looked overly affectionate for a father and son. A call had already been put out to ships about the two fugitives, and Captain Henry George Kendrell recognized the pair. Just before steaming beyond the range of his shipboard transmitter, he sent a wireless telegram to the British authorities. Crippen would be the first criminal to be captured with the aid of wireless telegraphy. On receiving the message, Inspector Drew boarded a faster White Star liner, SS Laurentic, from Liverpool, and arrived in Quebec, Canada, ahead of Crippen. Drew then boarded the Montrose disguised as a pilot, and Crippen was invited to meet the pilots as they came aboard. Drew removed his pilot's cap and said, "Good morning, Dr. Crippen, do you know me? I'm Chief Inspector Drew from Scotland Yard." After a pause, Crippen replied, "Thank God it's over, the suspense has been too great, I couldn't stand it any longer." He then held out his wrists for the handcuffs. Crippen and Ethel were returned to Britain, where they stood trial at the Old Bailey. Although none of the evidence presented seemed conclusive, but despite this, the jury found Crippen guilty of murder after just 27 minutes, and he was sentenced to death. Ethel was charged only with being an accessory after the fact and acquitted. Throughout the proceedings and at his sentencing, Crippen showed no remorse for his wife, only concerned for his lover's reputation. On Wednesday, the 23rd of November, 1910, 48-year-old Crippen was hanged at Pentonville, London. His last request was for a photograph of Ethel and some of her letters to be buried with him in his unmarked grave, a request that was granted. Over the years, questions have arisen about the investigation, trial, and evidence that convicted Crippen. And in October 2007, Michigan State University forensic scientist David Foran claimed that mitochondrial DNA evidence showed the remains found beneath Crippen's cellar floor were not those of Cora Crippen, and that the flesh samples found at the scene were that of a male. However, the new scientific evidence for Crippen's innocence has been disputed because the technique used was very new and done only by one team on a degraded sample. In December 2009, the UK's Criminal Cases Review Commission, having reviewed the case, declared that the Courts of Appeal will not hear the case to pardon Crippen posthumously. Crippen's name has lived on, and between 1910 until 2016, a waxwork of Dr. Crippen was on display in the Chamber of Horrors at Madame Tussauds in London. But in a curious twist, during the Dogger Bank earthquake of 1931, the strongest earthquake ever recorded in the UK, the head of Crippen's waxwork fell off and rolled along the floor in what many believed was a message from the grave. There is no doubt the investigation into Cara's disappearance was less than perfect. So could they have hung an innocent man? What do you think? The boy from Somosierra. This next case is well known in Spain, where it happened, but is less well known to the rest of the world. It's the mystery of what happened to the boy from Somosierra, a case dubbed Europe's Strangest Disappearance. Andreas Martinez was a truck driver who lived in the south of Spain, in Fuente Alamo, Murcia. On some of his trips, he took along his wife, Carmen Gomez, and their 10-year-old son, Juan Pedro. On June 24, 1986, Andreas was due to transport 20,000 liters of sulfuric acid up north to the Spanish city of Bilbao. Because Juan had done well in school, Andreas invited Juan and Carmen along for the journey. The family left around 7 p.m. after picking up the truck in the city of Cartagena, and by 6 a.m. the following day, the truck had entered Somosierra, a mountain pass to the north of Madrid. At this point, witnesses described the truck as being driven erratically and at speeds, as if it had a mechanical problem. Soon after, the truck broke off another driver's car wing mirror, and then it bumped into another car from behind, causing it to crash head-on with the truck that was travelling in the opposite direction. The impact caused Andreas's truck to overturn, spilling the sulfuric acid out onto the side of the road and covering the area with a toxic cloud. The authorities had to act quickly to neutralize the acid before it leaked into a nearby river. After the area had been cleaned up, sadly they found Andreas and Carmen's body in the crashed truck. However, Juan was nowhere to be seen. Although initially they weren't looking for him, as it wasn't until they spoke to relatives that they realized the boy was traveling with his parents. Investigators later re-examined the truck and surrounding area, but found no signs of Juan Pedro. Thought turned to the possibility that the sulfuric acid had melted his body, although chemists later dismissed the idea, as he would have had at least left behind some hair, teeth, or nails at the scene. Witnesses soon came forward and said the last time the family was seen was at a bar at around 5:30 a.m. on the morning of the crash, where there didn't appear to be anything untoward about their demeanor. After examining the truck, investigators discovered that there was nothing wrong with Andreas's truck, so there was no mechanical reason for him to be driving the way he was. However, his tachometer recorded that Andreas had stopped his truck 12 times as he went up the mountain during a period of 20 minutes, which does seem strange. To this day, nothing has been found of 10-year-old Juan, despite extensive investigations. So what happened to him? While there have been many theories, the most popular is that Juan was kidnapped and his father was pursuing his abductors when he crashed. This is kind of backed up by the driver of the car, who Andreas hit, who told police he was assisted by a man and blonde-haired woman in a white van. The woman was allegedly a nurse and looked over the man's injuries before driving away. The same couple were also allegedly seen pulling up to Andreas's truck after the collision and took something out of the cab, possibly a package or even Juan. This does seem a little far-fetched, but not beyond the realms of possibility. Others have suggested drugs were involved, although the family have strenuously denied this. Another theory speculates that Juan Pedro might have survived the crash and climbed out of the truck, and while looking for help stumbled upon the white van couple, who then abducted him. Or that he was burned by the acid and stumbled out of the cab, tried to make his way to the river to soothe his skin. Although considering the massive search for Juan Pedro after it was discovered that he was missing, it seems likely that he would have been found had he wandered around the area and collapsed or died somewhere. But Juan Pedro's family are hanging on to the belief that he is still alive. It's been reported that in May 1987, a man in Madrid met a blind old woman and a boy who looked like Juan Pedro. The woman was an Iranian refugee looking for the American embassy. She said that she and her family had been in Spain for only 6 months, yet the boy she was with spoke fluent Spanish, with an Andalusian accent just like Juan. When the man complimented the boy's strong Spanish, the old woman got nervous and wouldn't explain how he knew the language so well. Today, Juan Pedro would be 45 years old, and if he is still alive, how amazing would it be if he made contact? The Pottery Cottage Murders. When someone is convicted of a violent crime, we trust the system to keep that person safely incarcerated for the duration of their sentence until they are deemed fit to be released back into society. Sadly, in our next story, that was not the case, and the consequences were horrific. On the night of the 21st of August 1976, William Thomas Hughes followed a young couple he had met in a nightclub to a park where he beat the man with a brick and raped his partner. Hughes was quickly arrested after a tip-off from a member of the public and was remanded to Leicester Prison. However, despite a criminal past of violent behaviour, Hughes was allocated work in the prison kitchen, and on the 3rd of December 1976, he stole a boning knife that he managed to conceal from prison authorities, despite regular searches. It later transpired that limited information about how violent Hughes could be was not passed on to Leicester Prison, and because of his demeanour and good behaviour, they designated him as a low-risk Category B inmate. They didn't receive the full report of how dangerous he was until after he escaped. On the 12th of January 1977, Hughes was scheduled to appear at court in Chesterfield, and he was transported to the court in the back of a taxi, handcuffed to prison officer Ken Simmons. Fellow officer Don Sprittle was sat in the front next to the driver. So instead of Hughes having both hands cuffed, he had one hand free. The weather conditions during the 55-mile journey were horrendous. There had been heavy snowfall, and the traffic was disrupted. As they neared the end of their journey, Hughes insisted he needed to stop for a bathroom break. This was when he retrieved the stolen boning knife he had hidden on his person. And when he returned to the taxi, he stabbed Sprintle in the back of the neck before turning the knife on Simmons. After incapacitating both, he dumped the driver and the badly injured officers at the roadside. Hughes then drove the taxi off at speed, crashing into a wall along a road close to Beeley Moor in the Derbyshire Peak District of central and northern England. Police were soon notified of Hughes's escape, and an immediate search was ordered. However, initially they searched the wrong area, believing that Hughes wouldn't attempt to cross the exposed moorland in such bad weather, but they were wrong. Hughes had made his way across the moor and stopped at a remote farmhouse called Pottery Cottage. Hughes entered the home from the back door armed with two axes he had stolen from the garden shed. The only people home were Arthur and Amy Minton, who shared the cottage with their youngest daughter Gillian, her husband Richard Moran, and their adopted 10-year-old daughter Sarah. Hughes told Arthur and Amy that he was on the run from the police and needed to lay low until dusk. He promised them he wouldn't hurt them. Soon after, Gillian and Sarah arrived home, followed sometimes later by Richard, who found Hughes holding a knife to his wife's throat, threatening to kill her if anyone approached him. He forced Richard to the floor and bound his hands and legs. He then tied up Gillian and Amy, followed by Arthur and Sarah, who were in the annex. but Arthur strongly resisted and was brutally manhandled, dragged across the floor and tied to an armchair. Hughes then gagged all the adults and isolated them in separate rooms, taking Sarah through to the annex. Gillian, who was bound and gagged in her bedroom, heard the sounds of a commotion coming from the lounge below and realized it was her father being beaten. After the beating, Hughes casually made tea for his hostages and later sexually assaulted Gillian. The next morning, a local authority truck arrived to empty the septic tank. Hughes ordered Gillian outside to greet them, warning her to act normal. As she walked through the house, she caught a glimpse of her father, who appeared motionless in the armchair. Hughes dragged her away, telling her that he was asleep. Gillian also asked about her daughter's whereabouts, and Hughes assured her that she was asleep in the annex. After getting the family to call in sick to work and school, Hughes sent Gillian out alone to buy newspapers and cigarettes and check for roadblocks, warning her not to do anything stupid. Terrified of what he might do to her family, Gillian carried out his instructions. When Gillian returned, she noticed that her father had been moved. Hughes claimed that he was now in his bedroom. Throughout that day, Gillian made food for the family, and Hughes took it to them. He even took some soft toys into Sarah, claiming that she was really pleased to see them. Hughes reassured his hostages that he would be leaving that evening, and he untied Gillian, Richard and Amy, and they all drank whiskey together and played card games. Hughes prepared for his escape by sending Gillian and Richard out for supplies. During the journey, Richard tried to convince his wife that they should go to the police, but fearing for the life of her daughter and parents, she refused. That night, the weather conditions were so treacherous that Hughes decided to stay for a second night. The next evening, Hughes parted Pottery Cottage, leaving all his hostages tied up, but he decided to take Gillian with him. However, after driving several miles, he insisted they turn around and go back to the house, claiming he had forgotten a map. Hughes went back into the house alone and was gone for a considerable time. And when he returned, the car wouldn't start, so he sent Gillian unaccompanied to a neighbor's house to ask for a tow. There, she finally alerted them to the hostage situation. But they didn't have a phone, so they had to travel to get help. As Gillian walked back to the car, she could see her mother staggering in the snow before collapsing. Hughes then forced Gillian to approach another neighbor for help. This time he went with her, and soon they were on their way. By now, the first neighbor had alerted the police, and they had arrived at Pottery Cottage. There they found a scene of utter horror. Amy Minton lay dead in the snow, and inside the house they found the bodies of Richard, Sarah, and Arthur. All four had multiple stab wounds to the throat and chest. Cruelly, Hughes had kept up the pretense that Arthur and Sarah were still alive throughout, even pretending to speak with them, when in reality, it was clear they had both been murdered on the first night. The police soon caught up with Hughes and Gillian, and a high-speed chase ensued across Derbyshire and into Cheshire, ending when Hughes crashed into a wall in the village of Reno. As police tried to negotiate, Hughes held an axe over Gillian's head and demanded a vehicle in which to escape. To try and save Gillian's life, a car was provided. But when Hughes went to strike Gillian with the axe, police marksmen opened fire and shot Hughes dead. It was the first time an officer from Derbyshire Constabulary had shot anyone dead, and the first time British police had shot dead an escaped prisoner. Gillian was the only survivor. Starting in 2016, YouTube channel 00390 has been posting strange, creepy, and outright disturbing content for years. Very little is made clear about the identity or even the motives of the owner of the channel. What little can be gathered can only be learned from watching the videos, as the channel does not have a presence on social media as far as anyone knows. The videos in question are mostly shot in first person and come with titles like Confusion, which seems to depict the YouTuber showing off his favourite cooking implements, along with tools that do not fit in a kitchen, like chisels, drills, and a ball peen hammer. Another video entitled Choosing the Books seems to depict the YouTuber stalking a woman in a bookstore. As the channel developed, the videos became more bold and disturbing, with titles like How to Transport a Semi-Unconscious Girl and Torture Video for Kidnapped Girl. Mixed in with these videos are ones of him butchering and preparing meats, cleaning his kitchen tools, as well as occasionally random clips from Italian television. What little is known about the channel beyond the content it presents is this. The owner of the channel is at least trying to make the impression that he kidnaps girls, tortures them, and then eats them. He frequently edits his videos to have references to a lot of other creepy channels, like Marble Hornets, as well as serial killers Ted Bundy and John Wayne Gacy. The channel owner does appear to be Italian, living either in or near Milan in northern Italy. The channel recently got an uptick of attention due to a YouTube reviewer reviewing the channel and bringing attention to how bizarre and possibly illegal the content is. Sadly, this has actually made learning more about the channel more difficult, as in response to the increased traffic, the channel set a majority of their videos to private, leaving up only ones that could be easily construed as a cheap horror-style channel. Links to the older videos still do exist, but are hidden beyond that private setting. What do you make of this? The strange case of Karen Weldegrave. In 2011, something strange began to unravel on Facebook. People started to take notice of hundreds of unnerving messages that were being posted by a bright and promising young Canadian woman named Karen Catherine Weldegrave. Karen, who had at that point been active on Facebook for years, frequently used the platform the same way that many of us do, speaking on the progress of her life, like how she was on the way to acquiring her PhD and showing off her fluency in a variety of languages. Karen long appeared to be a very intelligent and perceivable individual. However, her status updates and messages suddenly took a turn into the bizarre, reading like the ramblings of a stereotypical conspiracist, touching on some well-known conspiracies as well as her own personal paranoias about being group-stalked or harassed by the Men in Black, Karen would ramble on about a myriad of topics. She would also mention random Estonian names like Alexar and Indrek, and frequently post long messages that seemed to be conversations conducted entirely with herself, ignoring even the comments of other posters. Her comments would often switch unpredictably from coherent to flat-out bizarre. And after a while, she began uploading personal images, all of which showed signs of film damage. It was after this that Karen began to mention the FBI and the CIA in her posts, talking about being controlled and monitored by them. She also mentions the illegal and perversive doings of the elite and how she knows of several international criminal networks. At times, these posts would degenerate into paragraph after paragraph of nonsensical gibberish, almost resembling an internet number station. After these posts, all of Karen's messages and posts were removed. Shortly afterwards, her account was deactivated, and that was the last anyone has heard from Karen Weldegrave, leaving us behind with far more questions than answers. Who was this woman? What happened to her? Did she have any mental illnesses that need to be addressed? Or was something else going on? Perhaps we will never know. Lake City Quiet Pills. Reddit is well known for its rabbit hole-like nature, and Lake City Quiet Pills is one such odd journey into what must either be a very particular and unusual role-playing game, or a dark web hub for contract killers. It all began in 2009, when Reddit user 26 posted an announcement regarding the death of his friend, fellow Reddit user Religion of Peace. According to his post, Religion of Peace had died at the age of 79, sitting at his computer with Reddit open. Normally a tribute post like that would simply fall from people's interest. However, some curious Redditors began digging through both of the users' post histories, and what they found there sparked one of the most pervasive mysteries on the internet. Both users were active on FARC, a precursor to Reddit, as well as the controversial subreddit r/jailbait, with Religion of Peace even moderating the page and running an image host of his own, titled That Old Guy's Image Host, for the users of the subreddit. Now, while that might seem unsurprising from someone moderating such a questionable subreddit, what did stand out was the URL of the image host, lakecityquietpills.com. On a FARC bulletin board, 26's signature mentions dispensing Lake City Quiet Pills to lousy people in need of permanent rest since 1968. Conspiracy fans believe that 26 was referring to bullets made at the Lake City Army Ammunition Plant. While all these things sounded odd, it was hard to prove that they were really connected in any meaningful way, until curious mystery lovers dug deeper in the only way they could, by digging into the source code of the website. That was when this mystery really exploded. Hidden in the code were messages exchanged between users, making strange and vaguely worded requests for what seemed like meetups between international travelers. Further into the code was an invitation to a party to celebrate Religion of Peace's will clearing probate. A few days later, an update to the code broke down the total cost of his celebration at nearly $100,000. Shortly after this, posts on Reddit regarding this mysterious website went viral, and the source code was changed to encrypted ciphers, repeating for thousands of lines of code, making the source code the equivalent to an internet number station. It took some time for armchair detectives to compare notes, for there to be any further development in this mystery. That was until one user discovered a link between the coded international requests previously mentioned and the assassination of a senior Hamas military commander in Dubai on January 19, 2010. After a lengthy international investigation, the suspects in the crime, who were never found or properly identified, used credit cards from Metabank of Storm Lake, Iowa. Storm Lake is located just one county away from Lake City, Iowa, the city in which the Lake City Army Ammunition Plant is based. There was also a request for American men meeting a Palestinian man in Dubai, among the odd requests in the source code. So could this website truly be connected with a ring of hitmen and mercenaries? With such a high-profile crime, why would a group of assassins use messages hidden in plain sight and use their supposed codenames on public and highly visible websites like FARC and Reddit? Could it be that way so no one would suspect a thing? After all, isn't the best kept secret one that is kept in plain sight? What do you all think of this one? GhostNet. GhostNet is the name given by researchers at the Information Warfare Monitor, or IWN, to a large-scale cyber-spying operation that was discovered in March 2009. GhostNet was discovered and named following a 10-month investigation carried out after the IWN approached the Dalai Lama's representatives in Geneva with the suspicion that their computer network had been infiltrated. It was through that investigation that the researchers discovered a vast network of compromised systems stretching all over the globe, well beyond the Dalai Lama's Tibetan exile centers in India, London, and New York City. These systems included the embassies of India, South Korea, Indonesia, Romania, Cyprus, Malta, Thailand, Taiwan, Portugal, Germany, and Pakistan, as well as the office of the Prime Minister of Laos. The foreign ministries of Iran, Bangladesh, Latvia, Indonesia, Philippines, Barbados, and Bhutan were also targeted. While there was no evidence found that US or UK government offices were directly compromised, there was a NATO computer that was infiltrated, as well as the computers of the Indian Embassy in Washington, DC. As far as anyone knows, this malicious software is transmitted as a Trojan virus via attachments on emails. When the Trojan is activated, it connects to a control server to receive commands. The infected computer will then execute any commands given by the control server, essentially allowing attackers to gain complete, real-time control of computers running Microsoft Windows. Such control can be used by the hacker to inspect any documents on the computer, as well as turn on the cameras and microphones of infected computers. Researchers from the IWM say that it's likely that GhostNet was an operation run by private citizens in China, for profit or for patriotic reasons, or created by intelligence agencies from other countries such as Russia or the United States, to gather information on neutral or aligned countries without arousing suspicion. Since being discovered, GhostNet has attacked other high-value government networks, such as Canada's financial and military research departments, forcing them briefly offline. To date, no one group or government has yet to take credit for these hackings, and it's not likely that anyone will anytime soon. Wayfair website human trafficking. This one may sound a little far-fetched, but it goes to show how quickly things can spread on the internet. Wayfair is an American e-commerce company that sells furniture and home goods. The company more or less follows the same sort of format as Amazon, using the internet as a way to easily and conveniently sell affordable furniture to people. But in July of 2020, Wayfair became the focus of a conspiracy that seemed disturbingly real. When Reddit user PrincessPeach1987 was looking for garage storage with her husband, she discovered that Wayfair sold a line of various cabinets and storage containers called the WFX Utility Collection, all of which seemed very strange. The first thing that stood out was that each item seemed extremely overpriced for its size, especially when compared to similar products on other websites like Amazon and IKEA. A comparable cabinet might cost about $1,000 on Amazon, but on Wayfair, the prices were fixed at anywhere between $10,000 and $18,000. No price was consistent, with cabinets sharing the same specifications and aesthetics, having hundreds, if not thousands of dollars in differences in cost. But what people found strange was that each cabinet had a name, but none had any particular common names, instead being called things like Yurtzer, Simia, and Alia, and having a number between 4 and 12 after the name. Many of these names match with the name of children missing in the United States, although not all seem to be reported. The more Redditors dug into the story, the stranger things got. For example, if you look up the stock keeping unit number or SKU of each individual product on the controversial Russian search engine, Yandex, which has been linked to human and drug trafficking in the past, you would find random stock images of children in bathing suits. Internet sleuths soon connected the 2019 Wayfair employee walkout to this conspiracy. The walkout occurred when employees learned that the management of Wayfair agreed to supply US immigration and customs enforcement detention centers with storage and furniture. Theorists say that these detention centers are the hotspots for which many of the names we see ascribed to cabinets come from, as these detention centers have a bad track record of misplacing and miscounting detainees. So could Wayfair, or one of the distributions who use Wayfair, be running a covert human trafficking ring, perhaps one that exploits the poor treatment of migrants in the US for profit? While naturally, Wayfair denied all of these allegations and promptly removed any trace of these cabinets from their site. So although this one may sound hard to believe, we might never know the full truth. The mysterious disappearance of the Anjikuni people. During the harsh Canadian winter of 1930, fur trapper Joe LaBelle searched for shelter from falling snow and bitter cold. He was close to Lake Anjikuni in the Northwestern Territory and knew there was an Inuit settlement in the area. As he stumbled into the village, he noticed how eerily silent it was. On previous visits, Joe had been greeted by a warm and bustling community. He carried on, hoping to find lodging, but soon realized the place was completely deserted. Joe found abandoned huts, smoldering fires, meals left out uneaten, and personal possessions and weapons left intact. As he continued to search, it became clear that the people of Lake Anjikuni had vanished. Something had happened that forced the entire community to abandon their homes. Just as disturbing was that every single dog in the village appeared to have starved to death. Suspecting something terrible had happened, and knowing the Inuit community would never leave behind valuable commodities for no reason, Joe hiked a few miles to the nearest telegraph station to alert the authorities. Hours later, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police arrived. As they travelled to the village, they were joined by trapper Armand Laurent and his two sons, who gave a curious account of what they had seen a few days earlier. They claimed that they had witnessed an airborne object heading in the direction of Lake Anjikuni that appeared to change shape as it moved. If that wasn't strange enough, when the Mounties searched the village and saw for themselves what Joe had described, they made another extraordinary discovery. In the graveyard, every grave had been opened and emptied, with the headstones neatly stacked on the side of the plots. How could a community of around 30 men, women, and children disappear without a trace, taking their dead with them? The Mounties immediately ordered a search party for the missing villagers, but failed to find anything. They did, however, discover a tied-up pack of dogs on the outskirts of the village that had died of starvation before being covered by snow. They also stated they witnessed strange pulsing lights in the sky above Lake Anjikuni. Although it's worth pointing out, these could have been the Northern Lights, although the officers claimed they were not like the natural phenomena that they were used to seeing. After a long and arduous investigation, the RCMP officers used berries found nearby to determine that the villagers had been gone for almost 2 months. However, it was apparent from the smouldering fires and prepared food that someone else had been using the village after they fled. The RCMP eventually concluded the disappearance was a seasonal or permanent abandonment, given the nomadic nature of the Inuit people. However, they did note it was odd for them to leave behind their weapons and provisions. As for the lights and craft witnessed, well, they were never explained. For many, this left a lot of unanswered questions, and several did not believe this explanation, which has left the case wide open to speculation. The most popular theory is that the Inuits were the victims of a mass alien abduction, and the strange aircraft and lights back this up. Others believe some malevolent spirit was responsible, possibly a Wendigo. The evil spirit, said to inhabit the forests and Great Lake regions of Canada and America. The Wendigo is known to invoke feelings of insatiable hunger and the desire to cannibalize other humans in those that fall under its influence. Others believe the Inuit sky god, Tongarasuk, was responsible. Another popular theory is that the members of the village were somehow pulled into another dimension. However, like many mysteries, the truth about what really happened at Lake Anjikuni has become distorted with the passage of time, and fact has given way to fiction. Yet we think you'll agree the story remains an odd one with no real conclusion, either rational or supernatural. Whatever the truth, the mysterious disappearance of the Anjikuni people remains one of Canada's most enduring mysteries, one that continues to trouble the vast northern wilderness to this day. The Gill family disappearance. When an entire family of six disappears, you would think that the whole world would know about it. However, in the case of the Gill family, there appears to be little information outside of Argentina, the place where it happened. The Gill family lived on the La Candelaria Estancia, where Menco Gill worked as a ranch hand and his wife Margarita worked at the local school. The estancia, or ranch, was around 500 hectares and was located in a town close to the city of Parana, the land belonging to Alfonso Goyetti, who was also Menco's boss. On January 13, 2002, the family travelled the 30 kilometres to Valier to attend the wake of their friend Maximo Vega. This was the last time anyone saw the family. 56-year-old Menco, his 26-year-old wife, Margarita, and their collective children, Maria 12, Osvaldo 9, Sofia 6, and Carlos 2, disappeared off the face of the earth. In mid-March of that year, Mencho's brother Otto tried to contact the family but got no response. Then his sister Luisa travelled to her brother's home, but again got no response. Then in June, Alfonso Goyetti showed up at Luisa's house asking where the family were, saying he was concerned they had not returned from a 3-month vacation. He even suggested that they could be staying in relatives in Santa Fe, or that perhaps they had travelled to look for another job in the north. Luisa was suspicious of this explanation, as previously Goyetti had only ever given them a maximum of 10 days leave, and after checking with friends and neighbours, none of them were aware they had planned a trip, and it seemed unlikely, as neither of them had a car. It was also revealed that Margarita had not picked up her latest salary. Luisa reported the disappearance to the police, however initially they leaned towards the hypothesis that the family had indeed gone on vacation, and perhaps found another job and not returned. Another relevant fact is that the family cell phone of the telephone company CTI continued to be active until April 2003, 15 months after the disappearance. It took until July 2003, 18 months after their disappearance, for police to investigate and search the area, but they found nothing. In the years that followed, investigators interviewed several people, searched various areas, and handed out missing person flyers, but nothing was found. In 2008, the fields in the area were excavated, wells were dug out, and in the family home the floor was raised. Traces of blood were found using luminol. However, the samples did not show the Gill's genetic pattern, although experts made it clear that over time the samples had been contaminated. Nothing much happened for the next 8 years, until on June 16, 2016, Alfonso died in a traffic accident. Alfonso's death produced an unexpected twist in the case. Armando Nani, a rural contractor who carried out planting work in the Goethe field and who knew Menko Gill, came forward. Nani hadn't wanted to speak before, out of fear of Goethe. But with Goethe dead, he made an extraordinary claim. He said that the Gills did not go on a trip to find work elsewhere. They were in fact buried in the area. He claimed that 20 days before the family disappeared, Menko Gill dug two wells, one in the bed of a stream that at the time was dry. Armed with this new information, on October 2017, investigators began excavating the two wells. However, just 2 weeks later, they had abandoned the dig. The first well did contain bones, but they belonged to animal remains. The second well, that was now filled with water, posed a significant and costly problem, and the additional funding needed to be approved by the judicial branch. Subsequently, the excavation stopped, and the field was planted with soy and returned to its normal purpose. The last thing that was known is a report produced by firefighters that surveyed the watercourse and provided a fact. The land had been removed previously, which would indicate previous disturbances or digging. And that is where the investigation is today. Nearly 20 years after an entire family disappeared, their fate still remains unknown, and the mystery rolls on. For the family, this must be agonizing, knowing that in all likelihood, their loved ones are buried in the field in which they worked and lived. Will the mystery ever be solved? Will they ever get justice and a decent burial? Or will money, or lack of it, prevent all of that? What's your thoughts and theories on this one? Disappearances of Paul and Sarah Skibber and Lorenzo Chivers. 9-year-old Sarah Ariel Skibber lived with her mother Michelle Russell in Granbury, Colorado. Michelle and Sarah's father Paul were divorced, and on the weekend of February 5th, 1999, it was Paul's scheduled visitation with his daughter at his home in Thornton, Colorado. Michelle and Paul shared custody of Sarah, and she spent every other weekend with her father and every Wednesday. Paul was devoted to Sarah, and he did everything he could for her. Paul lived with his mother Sharon and on-off girlfriend Teresa Donovan, who had recently given birth to a baby boy, although Sharon was out of town on this particular weekend. Although the arrangement wasn't always harmonious because Sharon and Teresa didn't get along, it later transpired that Paul had told his mother he was unsure whether the baby was his and was planning to have a paternity test. He was also going to ask Teresa to move out. Paul owned Tough Movers, a company based in Westminster, Colorado. He had built the company from scratch, and on Sunday, February 7th, Sarah had accompanied her father on a moving job in Morrison, Colorado. They were helped by one of Paul's employees, Lorenzo Chivers. The trio were last seen at approximately 6 p.m. that day, carrying out the moving job. This was the last time anyone seen or heard of them. The alarm was first raised by Teresa. She called Paul's mother Sharon on the Monday morning and told her that Paul had not arrived home the night before. He hadn't taken Sarah back to her mother's house either, and he hadn't shown up at work, even though he had a job lined up that morning. Lorenzo Chivers, who lived with Teresa's sister, was also missing. Teresa had phoned the police department, but stated they did not take her seriously. Sometime later, Sarah's mother Michelle also phoned the police, notifying them that Sarah had not been returned from her weekend stay with Paul. Investigators initially believed that Paul had abducted Sarah with Chivers' assistance, and a warrant was issued for Paul's arrest, and authorities thought the disappearances were related to a possible custody dispute. Investigators later discovered one of Paul's vehicles, which had been abandoned in the Westminster parking lot, used by his company, and it wasn't parked the way he normally positioned it. The truck had been pierced by two bullets and was smeared with blood. A piece of human skull with hair attached was inside, and there was additional hair on the truck's fender. Shell casings and blood were found in the parking lot as well. There was no sign of Sarah, Paul, or Chivers at the scene. Chivers' car was also found parked in the lot, but Paul's other vehicle was located in Denver, Colorado. DNA tests proved that the blood on the truck's door was Paul's. The blood on the ground outside was Paul's and Sarah's. The piece of scalp was from Paul, and the hair was Sarah's. Authorities changed the classification of the missing person's case at that time to endangered missing and announced that foul play was suspected in the disappearances. They believed Shivers, Paul and Sarah were ambushed and killed when they returned the truck to the lot, and that Paul was the probable target, and his daughter and Shivers were just in the wrong place at the wrong time. To date, no one has been charged with any involvement in any of the disappearances. The remains have never been found, and for the families, the mystery of what happened to their loved ones continues. The case is still very much open, and if anyone has any information, please call Westminster Police Department on the following number. Nina. In 2013, the 85-year-old 50-foot ocean racing schooner known as Nina disappeared without a trace on the stormy Tasman Sea, along with its American owner, David A. Deitch III, his wife and 17-year-old son, and four crew members. Nina was a celebrated, well-maintained vessel that in 1928 was the first American yacht to win the Fastnet race after a 600-mile sprint through the stormy English Channel and Irish Sea. David was a commercial mariner and diver with an extensive maritime background and an experienced skipper, more than capable of sailing Nina under adverse conditions. He also kept Nina in excellent working order, and she was equipped with a manually activated EPIRB, a spot beacon, a satellite phone, parachute flares, and a VHF radio. Nina left Opua in the Bay of Islands on New Zealand's North Island on May the 29th, 2013, bound for Newcastle, Australia, a 1,500-mile trip expected to take 8 to 10 days. Things appeared to be going to plan until June 4th when contact was lost. The last contact was at around 11:50 p.m. on June 3rd when Bob McDavitt, a New Zealand meteorologist, received a satellite phone call from Nina crew member Evie Nemeth, who said the weather had turned nasty and asked where Nina should go to escape the storm. McDavitt requested that she call back in 30 minutes while he prepared a forecast. She called and he advised Nina to go south and heave to until the swells abated, according to their coordination center, but be prepared for strong winds and high seas. He received no reply. He then texted Evie daily for several days after, but heard nothing. On June 12th, Evie's partner made contact with Australian SAR, voicing concerns that the Nina had not arrived at its destination. However, no action was taken until 13th of June, when RCCNZ commenced a communications search. This was followed by a physical search on the 25th of June that strangely commenced nowhere near Nina's last communicated position. Instead, they took the position from an Iridium satellite phone, a device that has questionable position reporting capability, although they did discover an undelivered text message from Nina at 11:50 a.m. on June 4th, the day Evie texted McDavitt. It read, "Thanks, storm sails shredded last night, now bare poles, going 4 km, 310 degrees, will update course info at 6 p.m. The undelivered text message clearly indicates that Nina was affected by the storm, but oddly gives no indication of immediate distress. The rescuers suspended their search on July 6th after overflying 737,000 square nautical miles of ocean, one of the largest searches ever for the agency, along with searches of the shoreline in the hope of finding survivors or debris. However, they found no sign of the vessel or crew. In the nearly 7 years since, nothing has been found, no debris has washed up, and all the searches have come up with nothing. It seems obvious that Nina was caught up in a vicious storm, but it seems strange that despite all the equipment they had on board, no distress signals were sent out. Nina probably sunk in a catastrophic event during one of the storms that had swept through the Tasman, although everyone remained hopeful that the crew had been able to abandon ship on a raft, although it seems sadly that was not possible. What is worth noting is that the location of the disappearance was within the area known as the Bass Strait Triangle, a stretch of water that has claimed several other ships and aircraft, and is perhaps best known for the disappearance of Australian pilot Frederick Valentich, who vanished after a UFO sighting in the area. The Indiana Dunes Mystery. On a hot summer day on Saturday, July 2nd, 1966, Ann Miller, age 21, got into a car and went to pick up two friends, Patricia Blau and Renee Brule, both 19, from their Chicago homes. The three had become close as they all kept horses at the local stable. After collecting her friends, Ann began the hour's drive to visit the Indiana Dunes State Park. After a brief stop along the way to buy sun cream, the trio arrived at the beach at around 10 a.m. The beach was packed that day with almost 9,000 visitors. Amongst them was a young couple named Mike and Frances, who set themselves down next to the three girls. At around midday, the young couple watched as the three women went for a swim, leaving their possessions on the beach. Shortly after, Mike and Frances saw the three women board a boat. As the hours passed and the sun started to set, Mike and Frances began packing up to leave, when they realized that the three young women had not returned, and all their belongings were still on the beach. Amongst the items were a purse, cigarettes, car keys, money, and clothes. The couple decided to hand in the items to a nearby park ranger, informing him they had last seen the women boarding a boat. When the three women did not return home that evening, they were reported missing. But it would be 2 days before the rangers realized the belongings that were handed in by Mike and Frances belonged to the missing women, and that Ann Miller's car was still in the beach parking lot. A full-scale search of the area was ordered, however the delay in linking their possessions hindered the investigation, as in the interim period, thousands of visitors had been on the beach, meaning locating any clues would be near impossible. They did establish, however, that Ann's car hadn't moved since the women arrived on the Saturday. On July 6th, debris was discovered on Lake Michigan's shoreline, but after the Coast Guard inspected reports, they found no one had reported a missing boat, and when divers went down near the spot, they were unable to detect anything at the foot of the lake. Despite widespread appeals for information on the whereabouts of the three women, no one came forward. The most significant lead investigators had came from an Indiana man who had been filming on the beach the day of the disappearance. After they inspected the footage he had taken that day, two boats became of special interest. The first was the same boat mentioned by the young couple from the beach, described as a 16 or 18 foot Tiramaran made of fiberglass, and with a distinctive three-hull design. The second was a 26 to 28 foot cabin cruiser that witnesses, including a lifeguard, claimed that they had seen three women climb aboard along with three men. However, despite their best efforts, law enforcement investigators came up with nothing. Over the years, there have been many theories. The most obvious is that the women were involved in an accident on the boat they boarded. Although if that was the case, the man on the boat would have also been reported missing, but no such report was ever logged. Unless, of course, an accident did occur in which the boat owner survived and he covered up the incident to avoid blame for the women's deaths. Another suggestion is that the three women drowned after getting into trouble while swimming, although this seems unlikely as no bodies have ever been washed up. Another theory is that the two of the women were pregnant by married men. At that time, abortion was still prohibited in Illinois, and this has led to the belief that at least one of the women died during an illegal abortion, and the other two women were then murdered to cover it up. Although again, there is little proof this could have happened. After all, why would a woman go to have an abortion in a swimsuit, not taking any of her clothes with her, and meet her abortionist on a beach? During the investigation, it was learned that all three women had personal problems. This led to the speculation that Ann Miller, Patricia, and Renee had planned their disappearance from the beach that day. Apparently, Patricia had even told a friend that she was going to leave and that no one would find her. But the fact that all their personal possessions, including money, was left behind, seems an unlikely thing to do if you plan to start a new life. Then there is the connection to the stables. Anne, Patricia, and Renee often rode at the Tricolor Stables in Illinois, which were owned by George Jane and his brother, who were involved in fraudulent activities, murders, and worse in the mid-1960s. In June 1965, Cheryl Ann Rood, a young woman, was killed at the Tricolor Stables by a car bomb that had been meant for George Jane. George had asked Cheryl to move his Cadillac from the stable entrance and the bomb exploded. Some believe that perhaps Patricia, Anne and Renee may have witnessed the bomb being planted, and as a result a hit was taken out on them. There was definitely a connection between the Janes and the missing women, as both men's telephone numbers were found in their belongings after their disappearance, and there is no question that the two men were criminals. George was shot to death in 1970, and his brother Silas was later convicted of conspiracy to murder his brother. He is also a suspect in the disappearance and probable murder of Candy heiress Helen Brack. However, neither brother has been positively linked to the women's disappearance. Even though Silas reportedly told a sheriff that he had three bodies buried beneath his residence, the sheriff took the claim seriously and planned to search the property, but before he could start the search, he was killed in a farming accident, and for whatever reason, it was not pursued after that. The sad fact is that the three women have now been missing for over 50 years, and no one is any closer to finding them now than the day they disappeared. The case is not unsolvable, but without any bodies or any solid new leads, it's unlikely that the truth will ever be known. Did they plan their own disappearance? Were they involved in a tragic accident? Or has something far more sinister happened to them? You decide. Peter Madsen. Peter Madsen was born in Denmark in 1971. During his school years, he developed an interest in rocket fuel and developed and launched his first large rocket on March 3, 1986. Ultimately, it crashed, but Madsen was hooked and continued to experiment and consult engineers. Despite having no formal education, he took courses in welding and engineering to learn about submarines. Many saw great potential in some of Madsen's inventions, and he gained financial support from people, organizations, and enterprises who saw promise in him. Madsen went on to build three submarines, UC-1 Freya, UC-2 Kraken, and UC-3 Nautilus. He also co-founded Copenhagen Subortials. Here is Madsen speaking in 2014 in an interview with Fabian Borgs at Copenhagen Subortials, in which he talks about his thoughts on von Braun, the pioneering German rocket scientist who invented the V2 rocket, the missiles the Nazis launched towards England in the final months of World War II.
Well, he means something to me. He means inspiration. And he is a complicated person to deal with because he started out working for the German military in the 1930s and 1940s, and we can be happy to say that he spent a lot of their money making pretty useless rockets that didn't make any difference for the German war effort, but that certainly made a huge difference for the development of spaceflight.
All seems pretty normal. However, less than 3 years after this interview, Peter Madsen killed a woman and dismembered her body in the most horrific way aboard one of his inventions. On August 11, 2017, Madsen was arrested after the sinking of UC-3 Nautilus and the disappearance of Kim Wall, a Swedish journalist who had last been seen alive aboard the submarine. Initially, Madsen claimed that Kim had disembarked the sub the night before the sinking. He later changed this statement, saying that Kim had died on board in an accident and that he had buried her body at sea. 10 days later, a human torso washed up on the coast of Amager, which DNA tests concluded belonged to Kim. The torso had been stabbed multiple times to release accumulated gases that would cause it to float to the surface, and a piece of metal had been fastened to the body to ensure it sank. On August 25th, Madsen's charge was extended to improper handling of a corpse. During a hearing on September 5th, Madsen stated that Kim had been killed when he lost his grip on the submarine's hatch cover, which he was holding open for her, and it hit her on the head, causing her skull to fracture. This proved to be a lie when, on October 7th, 2017, Royal Danish Navy divers assisting the police found Kim's head, arms and legs, along with a knife and pieces of her clothing, in bags at the bottom of Kuer Bay. All were weighed down with bits of metal, and it was found there was no fracture to Kim's skull. After continually changing his story about how Kim died, Madsen was eventually charged and convicted of her murder, and indecent handling of a corpse and sexual assault. He was sentenced to life imprisonment. On October 20th, 2020, a dramatic video was released, showing Madsen being recaptured after he escaped from prison. Police discovered that he was in possession of a pistol-like object and was wearing a belt that could potentially contain explosives, although it was later determined it was a decoy. Trent Pascal. On October 21st, 2020, 48-year-old Trent Pascal from Houston, Texas, posted a chilling video on YouTube in which he apologized to his children for killing their mother and his wife, 30-year-old Savannah.
I'm recording this because I want my daughter to know that I love you. I'm so sorry that I've done this. I want you to know that you mean everything to me. I love you too. I love you so much. I love you like you're my own. I didn't choose this. Your mom chose this. She's been cheating on me for a long time. There's an 18-year-old difference in her age. And I knew she was kind of too young. But I didn't, she's been playing me for a fool. I told her not to mess with me, not to mess with my emotions. Don't play with me. I'm like, why me? My hair's a mess and I look horrible. Oh, sorry. Take these off. I'm so sorry. I don't have better words right now. I'm hurting so bad. I don't know what else to do anymore.
Just minutes before the video was posted, Trent had ambushed his wife by hiding in a shower of their master bedroom, then jumping out and fatally shooting her twice in the stomach. Savannah's mother was also in the house at the time, but managed to escape and sought refuge with a neighbor who called the police. After Trent fled the house, she went back in and found her daughter dying. Savannah was taken to the hospital, where she was pronounced dead. The police later caught up with Trent after he left a Walmart, and deputies tried to perform a traffic stop, but Trent pulled out a pistol on them. A patrol sergeant shot him several times in the arm, leg, and upper torso. He didn't suffer life-threatening injuries and was later arrested at the hospital and charged with murder. The chilling video and subsequent murder was a far cry from a few years previous, when both Savannah and Trent posted gushing posts about each other on social media. If you looked at Savannah's Facebook page, you would think the marriage was very happy. It also seems Trent painted an unfair portrayal of his wife in his post-murder video. In reality, Savannah was a good person who worked at a funeral home and was trying to raise money to help victims of domestic abuse. It seemed her only fault was that she wanted to leave her husband, but he couldn't let her go alive. Issei Sagawa, the Japanese celebrity cannibal. You would hope that murdering a woman and then eating her would be enough to get you locked up for the rest of your life. Well, you'd be wrong. On June 11th, 1981, Issei Sagawa, a wealthy Japanese student who was studying in Paris, invited classmate Renée Hartevelt, a Dutch woman, to dinner. Under the pretext of translating poetry for a school assignment, she had no idea that what he really wanted to do was kill and eat her. After Renée arrived, she began reading poetry at a desk with her back to Sagawa when he shot her in the neck with a rifle. He claims he passed out at the shock of killing her, but when he woke up, he sexually assaulted her corpse and tried to eat her, but soon realized his teeth were not sharp enough, so he left his apartment to purchase a knife. Sagawa then consumed various parts of Renée's body. Some bits he cooked, and other bits he ate raw. When he was full, he saved pieces in the fridge to consume later, and also took photographs at various stages during the eating. Sagawa then attempted to dump the remains in a lake. Carrying Renée's dismembered body parts in two suitcases, but he was caught in the act and arrested by French police 4 days later. His wealthy father paid for a top lawyer, and after being held in Paris for 2 years, he was found legally insane and unfit to stand trial, and so was held in a mental institution in France. But rather than accept treatment, he did media interviews. A book was published about his life and his cannibalistic urges, and he became a macabre celebrity figure. Understandably, French authorities were concerned about this, and Sagawa was deported back to Japan. However, as the charges against him in France had been dropped, the French court documents were sealed and were not released to Japanese authorities. Consequently, Sagawa could not legally be detained in Japan. On August 12, 1986, he checked himself out of the hospital and has remained free to this day. Over the years, he has given graphic interviews about eating human flesh and has claimed that his obsession began when he was just a child. Unbelievably, once back in Japan, he was frequently invited to be a guest speaker and commenter and worked on several books and adaptations of his life, becoming a minor celebrity. Thankfully, this has all stopped, and Sagawa can no longer find publishers for his writing. He has rightfully so struggled to find employment, although he gave this interview to Vice magazine in
2011。小さなタオルを持って行って、血を頭の下に敷いて、それから服を脱がす。それから自分の書いたシナリオをずっと前からそういうシチュエーションを考えて、
Today, Sagawa lives alone and needs daily assistance after suffering a cerebral infarction. What is so unbelievable is that he has been a free man for nearly 40 years after he committed a crime that you would think would only happen in a movie. Thomas Whitaker, known as Bart. Kent and Tricia Whitaker lived in a smart house in Sugarlands, Texas. Their home and social life seemed near perfect, and their sons Bart and Kevin had all the privilege of being born into a wealthy family. Kent and Tricia were loving parents and enjoyed time with their sons, and Bart and Kevin had a close relationship. However, tragedy struck on December 10, 2003, after the Whitakers returned from a dinner to celebrate Bart's completion of his final exams. As they walked in their house, an unknown gunman shot all four of them. Tricia and Kevin sustained fatal chest wounds, and Kent and Bart were also shot. Kent sustained severe injuries to his upper body and clung to life, and Bart had a bullet wound to his arm. Thankfully, they both survived. Bart made this harrowing 911 call immediately after the shooting.
911.
Someone has just shot our neighbor.
Who's been shot?
Tricia and Kent.
Who shot them?
We don't know. Someone in a mask.
What kind of injuries do they have?
I don't know. They've just been shot.
Hang on just a second. We've got them calling on another line.
Shirley 911. Station emergency.
I've been shot.
Who's been shot?
It's my mom and my dad and my brother.
Hold on 1 second, sir. Engine 1, all we have one subject right now. Apparently the whole family's been shot. Stand by.
Is this Tricia or Kent?
This is Bart, the son.
Okay, Bart, where is your wound?
In the arm, my shoulder. I think I can't move my arm.
Okay, who else has been shot in the house with you?
I can't see.
Who else was in the house with you?
We were walking in the house. My brother and my mom and my dad. Oh, God.
I need you to hang on, Bart. I've got help on the way, okay? Do you know who shot you?
No.
Okay, your neighbors were telling me that he had a mask on. Is that true?
No. I think it's dark in here.
When the police arrived, they found a gun that was registered to Kevin, and damage to the gun safe in the home indicated it had been pried open and used in the shooting. In the aftermath of the shooting, Bart expressed his gratitude to the EMTs who saved his father's life. But as police and the media began looking into the family, it was discovered that unbeknown to his parents, Bart never finished college. He had transferred from Baylor University in Waco to Sam Houston State University, where he rarely attended and blew his tuition funds on himself. It also transpired that Bart was not quite the model son. He had a prior arrest for breaking into his high school and stealing computers. But perhaps the most shocking revelation of all came from Adam Hepp, one of Bart's friends, who came forward 5 days after the murders and told police that Bart had tried to enlist him to shoot his parents 2 years earlier and that Kent and Trisha knew about the plot but didn't take it seriously. As you can imagine, this opened up a whole new line of inquiry. Was the seemingly loving son from the seemingly perfect family responsible for murdering his mother and brother and seriously injuring his father? The police next focused on two of Bart's co-workers from the Brentwater Yacht and Country Club near Lake Conroe, Chris and Stephen. Both denied any involvement in the murders and provided DNA samples and scent test specimens. But the police were closing in, and in the summer of 2004, Bart had a tip-off that the police were about to arrest him. So with the help of a friend, Bart fled to Mexico, where he lived under a false name. He settled in the town of Cerralvo, where he soon found a girlfriend and got a job at a furniture store owned by her family. He told a string of lies whilst living there, saying he sustained the bullet wound to his arm while fighting in Afghanistan, and that his mother was a prostitute, and he had no contact with the rest of his family. A year and a half after the shooting, Stephen finally admitted that Bart hired him and Chris to help kill his family, after Bart had promised to cut both of them in on a $1 million life insurance payout he would receive after his family's death. The police offered a $10,000 reward to anyone who had information on Bart's whereabouts. For the friend who helped Bart flee to Mexico, the money was too much to resist, and he ratted on his former friend. Bart was soon hauled back to the US by the authorities, and him and his two accomplices were indicted for the murder of Trisha and Kevin Whitaker, and attempted murder of Kent. All three were convicted. Chris received life with the possibility of parole after 30 years. Steve got 15 years in exchange for testifying against Chris and Bart, and Bart was sentenced to death by lethal injection. However, in a remarkable gesture of forgiveness, Bart's father asked that his son be spared the death penalty, and he spent the next 10 years trying to save his son from the gurney and syringe. Due to his efforts, in February 2018, after spending years on death row, Bart's sentence was commuted to life in prison with no chance of parole. Over the years, both Bart and his father have given interviews, and it was revealed that Bart had been plotting to kill his family for several years. It wasn't just a spur-of-the-moment thing. The question is why.
I can go back and tell you why I felt so inadequate and why I felt that my parents didn't love me. And I recognize so many of the errors now. There's a difference between an excuse and a reason, and I don't try to make excuses for what I did. I try to... You can't make an excuse for this, but yeah, there were things that happened that were reasons for it.
From what we hear from friends of the family and so on, you seem like you had very loving parents who really gave you a lot. Is there something that we just don't know?
Well, even from a very young age, I believe that what my parents loved was an idealized version of me, and that I kept telling myself if I worked really hard and I succeeded that I would be that person. But I knew in my heart that I wasn't that person, and I felt like if they knew who I really was, that affection would dry up. And you can only go through that for so long before you start to bear a grudge against the people you think have set that high standard.
Did you love your family? Yeah. Did you love your brother, Kevin?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I was envious. He had so many of the qualities that I tried so hard for over the years. You know, people just loved him, always.
So you loved them, but you also hated them at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, we humans are kind of messy like that sometimes.
There was no abuse or trauma in his life. Quite the opposite. His parents were kind, generous, and loving. The only reason Bart could give was he felt he didn't live up to his parents' expectations and harbored jealousy for his brother. This doesn't seem like a good reason to want to annihilate your entire family. But maybe Bart is one of those rare sociopaths who was born rather than made. Bart currently resides in the McConnell unit in Beeville, Texas, in solitary confinement. He still gets regular visits from his father. Susan Powell. Susan Cox and Joshua Powell married in April 2001 after a short courtship. Both were followers of the Mormon faith, although Susan was more devout than her husband. For a brief period following their wedding, Joshua and Susan lived with Stephen Powell, Joshua's father, at his home in South Hill, Washington. But Susan became aware that her father-in-law Stephen had developed an obsessive infatuation with her and was secretly recording her. At Susan's insistence, the couple moved out and eventually relocated to West Valley City, Utah, where they went on to have two sons, Charles born in 2005 and Braden born in 2007. But all was not well in the marriage, and there was tension over Joshua's controlling behavior and refusal to attend church services with the family, as well with his continued contact with his father. The couple also had spiraling debt issues and Joshua's extravagant spending habits, and in 2007, Joshua filed for bankruptcy, declaring over $200,000 in debt. In July 2008, Susan recorded this alarming video.
This is me, covering all my bases, making sure that if something happens to me, our assets are documented.
Susan had confided in friends about problems in her marriage and was looking for a way out. On the morning of December 6, 2009, Susan, Charles, and Braden attended church services and then spent the afternoon with a neighbor in their home. The next day, friends and family were concerned that they couldn't contact either Joshua or Susan, and they reported the entire family missing. The police broke into the house, fearing that the family might be victims of carbon monoxide poisoning. They found no one inside, but noticed two box fans blowing at a wet spot on the couch. At about 5 p.m. the next day, Joshua returned home with the two boys and was taken to the police station for questioning. He claimed he had left Susan sleeping at home shortly after midnight on December 7th and had taken his boys on a camping trip to Simpson Springs in western Utah. This seemed highly suspicious. Why would Joshua take his young boys out camping after midnight when he was scheduled to go to work at his job just hours later and the weather was freezing? Police visited Simpson Springs, but found no evidence of the campsite that Joshua had described. After another search of the Powell's home, investigators found traces of Susan's blood on the floor and a handwritten letter from Susan expressing fear for her life. In another odd move, soon after his wife disappeared, Joshua acted quickly to liquidate Susan's retirement funds and cancel her regular appointments. He also withdrew his children from daycare. He gave several media interviews after his wife's disappearance. In this one, he explains why he took his young sons camping in such horrendous conditions on the night his wife disappeared.
We've gone out and done things like that before. We just were playing.
One report said it was a blizzard.
Maybe
Nobody goes camping on a blizzard.
Yeah.
It was later revealed that the couple's eldest son, Charlie, confirmed that the camping trip took place and that his mum had gone with them. However, young Braden told a different story when he drew a picture of a van with three people in it and told carers that mummy was in the trunk. Although the police didn't have enough evidence to charge Joshua with anything, he was a person of interest to them regarding his wife's disappearance. In the aftermath of Susan's disappearance, Joshua took his sons and moved back in with his father. The pair repeatedly tried to discredit Susan as a mother, spreading false rumors about her mental state. All the while, Susan's parents pushed for custody of their grandchildren, and after police discovered child pornography and secret videotapes of numerous women and young girls on Joshua's father's computer, they were awarded temporary custody of Charlie and Braden. Joshua did move out and was allowed to have visitation with his son several times a week, supervised by a social worker. Then on February 5th, 2012, Joshua and Braden ran up the path to Joshua's home, excited to see their father, closely followed by social worker Elizabeth Griffin Hall. But as they greeted their father, the door was shut on Elizabeth. What happened next was horrific. Soon after, the house exploded, killing Joshua and two children in a murder-suicide. The official cause of death for Joshua and the two boys was determined to be carbon monoxide poisoning. However, the coroner also noted that both children had significant chopping injuries on their head and neck with a hatchet, which was recovered near Joshua's body, and the house had been drenched in gasoline. Joshua named his brother Michael as the main beneficiary of his life insurance policy, and many suspected Michael, along with Joshua, was involved in Susan's disappearance. This belief was reinforced when on February 11, 2013, Michael took his own life by jumping off the roof of a parking garage. Charles and Braden are buried at Woodbine Cemetery, Washington, which also contains a memorial for their mother. Susan still remains a missing person, but given the fates of her sons, it's widely believed that she was murdered by her husband, possibly with the help of his brother Michael. Brazil's little-known radioactive accident. In 1985, a private radiotherapy institute located in the Brazilian state of Goiás moved to new premises. But without informing the authorities, they left behind a cesium-137 teletherapy unit that contained a small capsule containing about 93 grams of highly radioactive cesium chloride that, if fell into the wrong hands, could be deadly. The machine sat in the abandoned building in downtown Goiânia for over a year, whilst an ongoing legal dispute about the building and its radioactive chemicals ensued. Finally, in 1986, the court posted a security guard to protect the building until the dispute was resolved. However, on September 13, 1987, whilst the security guard was absent from his post, Roberto dos Santos Alves and Wagner Mota Pereira illegally entered the partially demolished facility and stumbled across the teletherapy unit. Thinking it might have some scrap value, they removed the source assembly, placed it in a wheelbarrow, and wheeled it to Alves' home. The two men then tried to dismantle the equipment. The following day, Pereira began to experience diarrhea and dizziness, and his left hand began to swell. He visited his local doctor, who told him his symptoms were the result of something he had eaten, and told him to go home and rest. Alves, however, despite also feeling unwell, continued with his efforts to dismantle the equipment, and eventually released the cesium capsule from its protective rotating head and succeeded in puncturing the capsule's aperture window with a screwdriver. As he looked through the puncture hole, he could see a glowing blue light coming from within the capsule. He then inserted a screwdriver through the hole and successfully scooped out some of the glowing substance. Thinking it may be a type of gunpowder, he then tried to light it, but the powder would not ignite. A few days later, on September 18th, Alves sold the items to a local scrapyard owner named Diver Alves Ferreira, who also noticed the blue glow from the punctured capsule. Thinking the substance was valuable or even supernatural, Diver took it to his house, and over the next 3 days, he invited friends and family around to view the odd glowing material. On September 21st, Diver's friend succeeded in freeing several rice-sized grains of the glowing substance from the capsule using a screwdriver. Diver then dished these glowing grains out to various friends and family members. On September 25th, 1987, Diver sold the device to a second scrapyard. However, the day before the sale, Diver's brother Ivo took some of the glowing substance home and spread it on a concrete floor. Later, his six-year-old daughter ate a sandwich while sitting on this floor. She was fascinated by the powder's blue glow, applying it to her body and showing it off to her mother. Dust from the powder fell onto the sandwich she was eating, and unbeknown to her parents at the time, she absorbed a fatal dose of radiation. Diver's wife was the first to notice that many people around her had become severely ill at the same time, and on September 28, 1987, 15 days after the item was stolen from the institute, she reclaimed the materials from the second scrapyard, and in a sealed plastic bag took them to a hospital. After tests, the presence of radioactivity was detected and immediate action was taken. News of the radiation incident was broadcast on local, national, and international media. Within days, nearly 130,000 people swarmed local hospitals concerned that they might have been exposed. Of those, 250 were indeed found to be contaminated. Eventually, 20 people showed signs of radiation sickness and required treatment. Sadly, those who had direct contact with the substance were not so lucky. The first to die was 18-year-old Admilson Alves de Souza, who was an employee of Diver Ferreira, who worked on the radioactive source. He developed lung cancer, internal bleeding, and heart damage, and died on October 18, 1987. A few days later, on October 23rd, little Lade Fiera died a horrible death. Her upper body swelled, her hair fell out, and she sustained kidney and lung damage, as well as internal bleeding. She eventually died of septicemia and generalized infection in Rio de Janeiro. Lead was buried in a common cemetery, in a special fiberglass coffin lined with lead to prevent the spread of radiation. Despite these measures, on the day of her burial, more than 2,000 people turned up at the cemetery to protest, fearing that her corpse would poison the surrounding land. They tried to prevent her burial by using stones and bricks to block the cemetery roadway. Nevertheless, she was eventually buried, but it was far from a peaceful send-off. Gabriella, age 37, the wife of Diver, and the person who alerted authorities to the sickness, also died on October 23rd. She developed hair loss and internal bleeding, especially of the limbs, eyes, and digestive tract, and died of septicemia and generalized infection, the same as her niece. Another employee, age 22, of Diver, developed serious respiratory and lymphatic complications and died on October 27th. Diver himself miraculously survived, despite receiving 7 gray units of radiation. But his life was blighted by the incident, and in 1994 he died of cirrhosis, aggravated by depression and binge drinking. His brother Ivo died of emphysema in 2003, after also being afflicted by depression. Hundreds of others were also affected after being exposed to low levels of radiation. In light of the deaths caused, the 3 doctors who had owned and operated the Radiotherapy Institute were charged with criminal negligence, and measures were put in place to ensure it never happened again. The incident is a tragic but little-known radiation accident that rarely gets talked about. The tragic tale of Charles Domery. Charles Domery was born in Bench, Poland in around 1778. He was one of 9 brothers, all of whom had huge appetites. Apart from his extraordinary appetite, Domery appeared normal in every other way. He was slightly taller than the average man at the time, standing at around 6'3", but was of average build and weight for his height. Domery was described as having long brown hair, grey eyes and smooth skin, with a pleasant demeanour, with no signs of mental illness, low intelligence or any other ailment. By the age of 13, Domery had enlisted in the Prussian army and became part of the army that besieged Thionville during the First Coalition War. However, the Prussian army was suffering from food shortages, which Domery found unbearable. So he surrendered to the French in return for food and was rewarded by the French commander with a large melon, which he immediately devoured, even eating the rind. Domery then enlisted with the French Revolutionary Army and shocked his new comrades with his unusual eating habits and voracious appetite. Despite being granted double rations and using his pay to buy additional food, he still suffered from extreme hunger. It is said that in a single year, whilst based at an army camp near Paris, Domery ate 174 cats, leaving just their skins and bones, and munched through 4 to 5 pounds of grass every day. Domery's favourite food was a raw bullock's liver, and he preferred all his meat uncooked. It was later noted by the doctors who studied him that he never vomited other than when fed large amounts of cooked meat. But perhaps one of his most inhumane acts happened while he served on board the French ship Hoche. One of his fellow sailors had his leg shot off by a cannon fire, and instead of helping him, Domery grabbed the severed limb and began to eat it, until a crew member wrestled it from him and threw it into the sea. In October 1798, a Royal Navy squadron under the command of Sir John Bolas Warren captured the Hoche off the coast of Ireland, and those on board, including Domery, were incarcerated in a prison camp near Liverpool. The British guards at the prison were shocked by Domery's appetite and agreed to place him on double rations, but these were still insufficient for his needs, and his rations were continually increased, until eventually he was granted the rations of 10 men each day. But Domery still remained hungry, and went on to eat the prison cat, and at least 20 rats which had strayed into his cell. It was also noted that he would regularly eat the prison's candles, and the medicines of those prisoners in the camp's infantry who refused to take them, but suffered no apparent adverse effects as a result. He would also resort to drinking contaminated water to wash down his food after his rations of uncontaminated beverages ran out. Disturbed by Domry's obsession with food, the prison commander alerted the medical services responsible for overseeing the welfare of prisoners of war. Dr. Johnston and Dr. Cochrane were assigned to his case and performed a test to measure Domry's eating capacity and tolerance for unusual foods. These were the observations they made. At 4 a.m, Domry was awakened and fed 4 pounds of raw cow's udder, which was eaten without hesitation. At 9:30 a.m, he was given a meal of 5 pounds of raw beef, 12 large tallow candles totaling 1 pound, and a bottle of beer, all of which were consumed. At 1 p.m, Domry was given another meal of a further 5 pounds of beef, a pound of candles, and 3 large bottles of beer, all of which were also eaten and drunk. During the course of the experiment, he did not defecate, urinate, or vomit at any point. His pulse remained regular, and his skin did not change temperature. Upon Domray's return to his quarters at 6:15 p.m. following the conclusion of the experiment, he was recorded as being of particularly good cheer, and danced, smoked his pipe, and drank a further bottle of beer. The cause of Domray's appetite is unknown, and there have been no modern documented cases of polyphagia, excessive appetite, as extreme as his. It's speculated Domry may have suffered from hypothyroidism, a condition that can induce an extreme appetite and rapid weight loss. However, because it is not recorded what became of Domry after his release from prison, no follow-up of his symptoms were made. The Von Erich Family Curse. The Von Erich family is an American professional wrestling family originating from Texas. The family's actual surname is Adkisson, but every family member who has been in the wrestling business had used the ring name Von Erich, which was originally devised by the family patriarch Jack Adkisson, known professionally Fritz Von Erich, as he portrayed a villainous German Nazi character in the ring. Outside of their wrestling careers, the Von Erich family are most notable for the alleged curse surrounding them. When Jack Adkisson, 68, passed away from cancer in Denton County in 1997, all but one of his children had predeceased him. The firstborn child, Jack Baron Adkisson Jr., was born September 21, 1952. When playing outside the family's Niagara Falls, New York home in 1959, he received an electric shock from an exposed wire and fell unconscious into a puddle where he drowned. He was just 6 years old. Moving on to the third Adkisson child, David Allen was born July 22nd of 1958. He married in 1978, aged 20, and had his first daughter that year. But tragically, she died in infancy. David and his wife divorced less than a year later, and he remarried in 1982. On February 10th, 1984, David died while in Tokyo, Japan. The US Embassy's death report claimed that the 26-year-old died of acute enteritis, which is the inflammation of the small intestine. But Ric Flair, a professional wrestling manager, claimed that everyone in wrestling believed David's death was a drug overdose. He added that the wrestler who found David had disposed of the narcotics by flushing them down the toilet before law enforcement arrived on the scene. Kerry Jean Adkisson, the fourth child, was born on February 3, 1960. He took his own life on February 18, 1993, on his father's ranch in Denton County, Texas, by shooting himself in the chest with a .44-caliber gun. A retired professional wrestler named Bret Hart claimed that Kerry had told him in the months prior to his death that he planned to commit suicide. He reportedly wanted to follow his late brothers and said that they were calling to him. His marriage had fallen apart and he believed that his death was inevitable. Sadly, this was just the one of many suicides in the Adkisson family. Mike Brett Adkisson, the second youngest child, was born on March 2nd of 1964. Shortly after his wedding in 1985, he had to get surgery after injuring his shoulder. Afterwards, he was found to have toxic shock syndrome. As a result of his condition and his surgery, he was unable to return to the ring at full strength and was forced to retire. He took his own life on April 12th of 1987 in Denton County by overdosing on tranquilizers. He was just 23. The last child of Jack Adkisson was Chris Barton, born September 30th, 1969. There were many factors which influenced his wrestling career and made it impossible for him to reach the success that his siblings had in the ring. Chris was only 5'4" and suffered from both asthma and brittle bones. making him a less than ideal candidate for a wrestling career. After years of being unable to live up to the Von Erich family name, Chris became depressed and frustrated. Additionally, he was heartbroken over the loss of his brother Mike. In 1991, just 18 days before his 22nd birthday, he took his life via a gunshot to the head. The only surviving member of the second generation of the Von Erich family is Kevin Ross Atkinson, who was born on May 15th, 1957, and is the second oldest of the siblings. He is known professionally as the Golden Warrior and had a successful career in pro wrestling. He has four children with his wife, whom he married in 1980. His two sons have had their own successful wrestling careers. The third generation of Von Erichs has managed to evade the so-called family curse, but the tragedy surrounding the family is horrifying nonetheless. Piseth Pilika. Born December 4, 1965, Piseth Pilika was a Cambodian ballet dancer who had an extremely successful career during the 1980s and 90s, where she appeared in numerous films, advertisements, and karaoke videos. Piseth began to study Cambodian cultural dance in 1980. Her aunt, a fine arts teacher, was incredibly supportive of his choice of career. Piseth completed her studies in 1988 and continued to work at the school as a lead dancer. As her popularity grew, she was invited to star in her own film, translated as Shadow of Darkness. It was here during her acting career that the young woman met a well-known actor named Kai Praseth. The couple married in 1990, and 2 years later they had their first child together. As well as having a successful on-screen career, Piseth was also an active stage performer who toured across the US, India, Japan, China, Korea, Thailand, and in various countries throughout Europe. On July 6, 1999, Piseth was shopping at Phom Phez O'Russell's Market when she was shot in broad daylight by an unknown male assailant. Her 7-year-old niece was also wounded in the shooting. Piseth was in critical condition in hospital until July 13th, when she passed away. She was only 34 years old. Her funeral attracted over 10,000 mourners, making it one of the largest attended ceremonies in recent Cambodian history. Piseth's murder was a high-profile case, but despite this, it remains cold. Just months after the shooting, in October of 1999, the French magazine La Express claimed that the actress's diary exposed an affair she was having with the Cambodian Prime Minister, a man named Hun Sen, who has been in power since 1984. Upon discovering this affair, the magazine pointed the finger at the Prime Minister's wife, Bun Rani, and alleged that she had ordered a hit on Piseth. The magazine added that on her deathbed, the 34-year-old actress had named Bun Rani to several people, something which Bun Rani denied, before announcing that she would bring charges to the magazine for defamation. La Express shot back, claiming that they had proof they'd produce in court if the case went ahead, including witnesses, documents, and business papers that would prove the affair, and that Piseth was murdered out of jealousy. During the couple's affair, the Prime Minister allegedly gave her checks, which Bun Rani later blocked her from accessing. He also reportedly gifted Piseth a house. One journalist who worked for La Express noted that the diary had been verified as belonging to the 34-year-old. Handwriting experts had analysed it, and fingerprints on the diary were matched to Piseth. Hun Sen has denied any involvement in the murder of Piseth, and also denied being involved in an affair with the actress. At the time, he blamed the opposition party leader for fabricating the claims. Bun Rani never brought charges against the French magazine. In January of 2013, a book named Piseth Pilika, A True and Horrible Story was published, which contained extracts from the 34-year-old's alleged diary. In it, Piseth detailed her relationship with a high-ranking official and noted the violent threats she'd received from the official's wife. The book reportedly sold well until it was taken from the shelves by undercover police officers. Piseth Pilka's case is still unsolved. No charges have ever been brought, and no suspects have ever been identified. The kidnapping of foreign engineers in Chechnya. On October 3rd of 1998, a well-armed group of around 20 Chechen-speaking men captured four foreign engineers from their home in Grozny. the capital of the Chechen Republic of Echeria. The victims of the abduction included three British men, 46-year-old Peter Kennedy, 26-year-old Darren Hickey, and 42-year-old Rudy Petschke, as well as one New Zealander named Stan Shaw, who was 58 at the time and had been living in the UK. Three of the men were employed by Granger Telecom, while Peter Kennedy was employed by British Telecom. The men were in Grozny to install a telecommunications system at the time of their vanishing. Reportedly, the attackers had a brief gunfight with the bodyguards of the men, during which one of the kidnappers was injured. The sound of gunfire was so frequent in Grozny that the engineers didn't think anything upon hearing it and didn't react. They were quickly grabbed by the group of men and taken hostage. It wasn't long before law enforcement became involved in the case. Authorities launched raids on the homes of suspected kidnappers, releasing over 60 hostages in the process, but the four engineers were never located. Several suspects were arrested in the case, but they were released quickly, as authorities were hindered by a lack of evidence. Less than a week later, on October 8th, a spokesman for Chechnya's security ministry said that the men were alive and well, but that the kidnappers were yet to announce any ransom demands or conditions for their release. At the end of November, the criminal group finally made a statement where they promised the four engineers would be released in exchange for $10 million. The British Foreign and Commonwealth Office, however, already announced that it was government policy not to pay ransoms, but Granger Telecoms agreed to find the money. On December 8th, the heads of all four men were found in a sack on the side of a highway in a Chechen village. They were identified by one of their bodyguards. In a press conference 2 days later, the vice president showed a recorded videotape in which the four victims were forced to dress in military uniform and confess in Russian to spying for German, English, and Israeli special services, as well as the CIA. Security forces claimed that the men were slain at an unused factory south of Grozny after a rescue operation went wrong. It was suggested that the executions were a show of defiance to authorities by the kidnappers. The families of the victims claimed that the botched rescue attempt ruined the negotiations that were going on between Granger Telecom and the perpetrators. At the end of the month, on December 29th, officials located four headless corpses on the outskirts of Grozny. They paid $2,000 per body for their return. All four men were flown back to the UK, where the medical examiner determined that they had been starved of food and water, tied up and repeatedly beaten. They'd been decapitated using a large knife and were extremely malnourished at the time of their demise. Although there have been several suspects in the slaying of the men, nobody has ever been charged. Most of the suspected perpetrators are warlords, and the case appears to have gone cold. Jesse Ross. Jesse Ross was a 19-year-old student at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, where he majored in communications and minored in politics, when he went missing in 2006. It all began on November 18th, 2006, when Jesse traveled with a group of 13 other students to Chicago, Illinois, to participate in a four-day mock United Nations convention as part of his studies. On the final night, November 21st, Jesse and his fellow students attended a dance hosted by the conference organizers at the Sheraton Towers Hotel, located in the 300 block of East North Water Street. Just before 12:30 a.m., however, there was an emergency meeting with the mock United Nations Security Council. Jesse attended the meeting, and afterwards, everyone returned to the dance. His friend and roommate, Ralph Parker, stated that while Jesse had been drinking at the event, he wasn't drunk when he left at around 2:30 a.m. after stating that he needed a break. At this time, Jesse can be seen on CCTV camera leaving the building. It was thought that the 19-year-old was heading back to his hotel, a walk which would have been well lit and heavily monitored and was only a 10-minute long journey. However, Jesse was never picked up on surveillance footage and never got back to the hotel. When his roommate Ralph returned to their shared hotel room at 6 a.m, it was still dark and empty. He believed Jesse was in bed because the clothing and other items heaped on its surface made it look as if someone was under the covers. The following day, however, Jesse's professor noticed his absence and he reported it to the authorities. It was initially speculated that Jesse had fallen into the nearby Chicago River, which was in the opposite direction of where the students were staying, which would explain why the 19-year-old was never seen on camera. Searches of nearby hotels and the local neighborhood turned up no trace of the absent student, and family and friends reported that Jesse had no personal problems at the time of his disappearance. In the years following his disappearance, Jesse's bank account has never been used, nor is his mobile phone. In 2017, his parents thought that remains located in Lake Michigan were that of their missing child, but this does not appear to have been the case. Jesse was a well-liked, enthusiastic, and driven young man. His unpaid internship at Kansas City Radio had led to him being promoted to a paid position. On the air, he went by the name Opie Cunningham, and he hosted a morning radio show called Shorty and the Boys. His successful job and good grades in school indicated to friends and family that he was happy with his life. He showed no signs that anything was wrong, and his vanishing has left his loved ones puzzled. For many, it seems likely that a tragic accident befell the young man. But what exactly happened to Jesse that November night is still unknown, and his case remains unsolved. The Saudi Prince. In October of 2010, 34-year-old Abdul Aziz Al Saud, the grandson of the billionaire king of Saudi Arabia, was convicted of the murder of his servant, a brutal crime that, according to prosecutors, was the end result of a stream of never-ending sadistic abuse. The prince killed his 30-year-old servant, Bandar Abdul Aziz, at their five-star hotel suite in central London after they'd returned from a night out on February 14, 2010. Reportedly, the prince frequently attacked his servant for his own personal gratification. While in the early hours of February 15th, Bandar was worn down, suffering from a swollen eye and cauliflower ear from previous assaults. According to prosecutors, he simply didn't have the energy to fight back, and so he let himself die at the hands of the prince. The prince ordered beverages from room service as he went about moving the body and cleaning up the spilled blood. When Bandar was discovered by a chauffeur, the prince claimed that he'd attempted to revive his friend who'd gained his brutal injuries a few weeks prior when he'd been robbed on the streets of London. However, it wasn't long before detectives recovered the hotel's CCTV, which clearly showed the prince attacking his servant, not once but on multiple occasions. The crime was deemed to also be partially sexual in nature, although the prince said that they were friends and equals. The prince stated that he was heterosexual and that he had a girlfriend back in Saudi Arabia. But investigators discovered that he'd spent time with male escorts and gay massage therapists. The murder was brutal. The pathologist noted that Bandar had been a victim of many, many assaults over an extended period of time. His cause of death was from being beaten and strangled. He'd received heavy blows to the head and face. His left eye was so swollen it was closed, his lips were split, and his teeth were chipped and broken. There were also bite marks on his cheeks. In October of 2010, the prince was trialed at the Old Bailey, where he was found guilty by a jury. He was convicted not only of murder, but also of GBH, with intent, for the attack carried out on CCTV. Bandar was an orphan who'd been adopted into a middle-class family at a young age. He'd spent the previous 3 years travelling with the prince as an occasional companion, and the pair had met through mutual friends. They had been staying at the Landmark Hotel in Marylebone since January 20th. While it is a positive that the case has been solved, it's nonetheless a horrifying tragic event with an eerie piece of CCTV footage. Moments before, the man in the video met his demise. Jackie Sutton. This CCTV footage from Ataturk Airport in Istanbul in October of 2015 seems perfectly ordinary, as it shows passengers walking through the halls and heading for the bathrooms. But this footage is attached to an extremely controversial case. On October 18, 2015, 50-year-old Jackie Sutton arrived at the Turkish airport at around 10 p.m. She was scheduled to fly out of Erbil, Iraq, near midnight. Jackie was a former BBC journalist who had recently become part of the Institute for War and Peace Reporting, an independent organization that worked with the media to promote positive change in conflict zones and closed societies around the world. Jackie had been brought on as the lead Iraq director. It was a dangerous job, but one which she reportedly loved to do, as she enjoyed helping others and was a staunch advocate for women's rights. She was also extremely vocal about her support of local journalism. Jackie was, by all accounts, a well-respected journalist who was headstrong, tough, and very intelligent. The events that unfolded when she arrived in the Turkish airport that October night have caused much controversy and confusion amongst both onlookers and those who loved and knew her. Upon arriving at the airport, Jackie was seen on CCTV heading towards a cafe where she ordered a beer and read a book. About an hour later, she headed to the waiting area. Here, the 50-year-old fell asleep, resulting in her missing her flight. She reportedly could not purchase a new ticket as she had insufficient funds. Afterwards, surveillance showed Jackie heading to the bathrooms. Several other women entered and exited the bathrooms over the next 10 minutes, and nobody reported anything strange. Then three women were seen entering the facility together before they quickly emerged again in complete shock. Jackie was found dead. Her death was ruled as a suicide, and authorities believed that the reason she took her own life was because she did not have the money to buy a new plane ticket to Iraq. While many see this as an odd reason for someone to take their own life, it must be noted that mental health is hardly a rational thing. That said, this reasoning is extremely confusing, given that Jackie had several thousands of euros on her in cash when she was found. She was also a well-travelled woman and was not new to having issues as she journeyed across the globe. Colleagues of hers also pointed out that her work would have paid for the flight. When looked at from this angle, the police's reasoning as to why Jackie took her own life seems odd. Many have noted that Jackie was doing an extremely dangerous job. If she had been killed in her line of work, she certainly wouldn't have been the first. The previous director had been killed in a car bomb just months before Jackie took over, and another journalist for the organization had been slain by extremists in 2007. The details of Jackie's death appear to mostly be under wraps, even 5 years on from the case. Initially, her family believed that she had been murdered, but later in 2015, they changed their opinion, stating their belief that she had taken her own life, a belief which they based on the evidence they'd been presented with. However, Jackie's demise is still widely debated online. What's your thoughts on this one? Victoria Hall. Victoria Hall was just 17 years old when she went missing on her way home from a nightclub in Suffolk in 1999. In the early hours of Sunday the 19th of September, at around 1 a.m, Victoria left the nightclub with her friend to head home. The pair separated at around 2:20 a.m, close to the 17-year-old's home. A few minutes after Victoria and her friend, 19-year-old Gemma Alger, parted ways, the older girl heard two screams, but didn't think anything of it, and assumed other people were just messing around. The decision to not check on her friend would soon prove to be a wrong one. Victoria never made it home, and her parents reported her missing later that Sunday. There was huge media interest in this case, leading to the police receiving thousands of calls. Tipsters gave what information they had, and described possible sightings of the young girl. But just 5 days later, on September 24th, Victoria's body was found in a watery ditch by a dog walker. She had been suffocated to death. On December 18, 2000, a 27-year-old businessman named Adrian Bradshaw, who ran a local newspaper called Felix Stowe Flyer, was arrested and charged with Victoria's murder. He appeared in court in November 2001, but was acquitted when the jury returned a not guilty verdict. The evidence against Bradshaw relied heavily on geological soil samples, which caused much argument between prosecutors and the defense. Prosecutors believed that Bradshaw had lied about his whereabouts at the time of Victoria's disappearance, and that the mud found in his car was similar to that found where her body was dumped. Witnesses, however, claimed that Bradshaw had gotten out of his taxi near to where Victoria vanished at around 2:30 a.m. and had spent part of the evening at the same club as the 17-year-old. However, a geologist for the defense said that the soil found in Bradshaw's car could have come from almost anywhere in East Anglia. In 2019, on the 20th anniversary of Victoria's demise, Suffolk police reopened her case. 40 calls were received in the first few months of its reopening, leading to dozens of new lines of inquiry. As part of the new investigation, 9,000 statements, documents, messages, and reports were re-examined, and the movements of over 70 individuals were revised. 12,000 links to police and vehicles are currently being worked through. For the first time, images were released of what clothes the 17-year-old was wearing on the night she disappeared. Her clothing and possessions have never been recovered. The contents of her handbag were also disclosed. Not only this, but investigators released this CCTV footage of unidentified people visiting the field in Creating St. Peter, where Victoria's body was recovered. The footage was captured in the months following her death, and those on the recording have yet to be identified. It's unknown what they were doing in the field. And information on these individuals has been given to the police, but so far, the tips have not led to the case being solved. Victoria was described as a happy and caring teenager who always had a smile on her face. As you can imagine, the case is still unsolved, and so if you have any information on her demise, you can email unsolvedcasereviews@norfolk.pnn.police.uk. Dale Kerstetter. Dale Kerstetter was a 50-year-old man who lived in Bradford, Pennsylvania his whole life. He was last seen on September 12th of 1988 at 11 p.m. during his weekend shift at work. Dale was a security guard and maintenance man at Corn and Glass Works in Bradford, and he'd been employed there for almost 30 years. On the morning of September 13th at around 7 a.m, another guard came to relieve Dale of his duties. However, the 50-year-old was nowhere to be seen. His lunch pail, newspaper and keys were located on a cafeteria table, and his truck was still in the parking lot. A search of Dale's truck showed his keys were still in the ignition and that his 22 caliber handgun was missing, but its holster had been left behind. There was no trace of him in or around the plant, and there were no signs of a struggle nor any signs of forced entry. Police sniffer dogs traced the 50-year-old's scent to the second floor of the plant, where a glass furnace was located. This area was not part of his normal security rounds. It should be noted that the furnace was not on, as none of the equipment was on or working at the time. Then police noticed that $250,000 worth of platinum pipe was missing. They turned to the surveillance cameras in the building, where they found multiple recordings of a masked intruder in the back area of the plant. In one shot, the unidentified man was seen in the area in which the platinum went missing. In another, Dale could be seen talking to the thief. As both men walked along the second floor, Dale looked up directly into the CCTV camera. It's unknown if he was asking silently for help or if he was flaunting his crime. A third shot from the CCTV shows the intruder wheeling out a large bag thought to either contain Dale's body or the platinum. It cannot be determined which without further evidence. While Dale had financial issues at the time of his disappearance, there is much debate about whether or not he actively participated in the platinum theft. Authorities believe that he may have been involved, but his family strongly disagree. He was very close to his 6 children, and they believe that he wouldn't have left them. One of his daughters noted that security guards at the plant were meant to check in every hour, but that her father didn't during his shift. Dale's employer also believed he was involved, as he'd recently taken a hit to his wages after being cut from the trade program. However, he was known as a loyal employee. Online sleuths have postulated that perhaps the masked man was a former or current employee, as the thief knew how to retrieve the platinum and where to find it, along with the equipment needed. Dale's teenage son, who lived with him at the time, believed that his father was in hiding. His daughter believed that he'd been killed and was not involved in the theft. Dale has never been located, and his case continues to go unsolved. He was declared legally dead in July of 2014. Gettysburg Ghosts. The Gettysburg Battlefield in Pennsylvania is known to be one of the most haunted areas in the US. It's the site where over a 3-day period in July 1863, one of the bloodiest battles ever fought on American soil occurred, with the loss of nearly 10,000 Union and Confederate troops, with another 30,000 wounded. We have featured this area before in one of our first creepy ghost videos, and over the years, a flurry of photographs and videos have been released, allegedly showing paranormal activity at the site. The video we are about to show you is one of the latest and most convincing. It was captured by Greg in September 2020, when he was driving through the historic site on a visit with his family. As they drove through the area at night, they started hearing noises and looked around to see what it was. That's when they noticed a weird fog patch near the cannons. Greg decided to video the weird phenomenon on his phone, and when they looked over the footage later, this is what they saw. Considering the reputation of the area, we must admit that looks pretty creepy. Of course, it could be a camera glitch or a reflection, but we like to think it's the ghost of one of the poor souls that perished at the Battle of Gettysburg. What do you think? Mystery of the Slamming Door. This next one was posted to Reddit on September 1st, 2020 by user Blin11. His roommate, who worked a later shift to him, had been complaining that when he was getting ready for work in the mornings, he kept hearing a door opening and shutting. Initially, they assumed it was just a neighbor, as at first, nothing showed up on the security camera. However, when his flatmate went on vacation and the security camera was turned on at an earlier time, when Blin11 left for work, he was shocked to get a notification from the camera at around 11 a.m. the time his flatmate usually heard the door slamming. Take a look. Blin11 explained in the comments that the door was to his bedroom and was latched shut when he left the house, and he has no idea what caused it to open and shut like that. As you can imagine, Reddit users questioned whether the footage was fake, although Blin11 assured them that it wasn't. The apartment is a fairly new 2-bed and 2-bathroom home, although Blin11 had no history on the place. Many believed that the movement was caused by paranormal activity, and although the poster was skeptical, he still had no explanation for the strange phenomena. It's a pretty strange thing to have pop up on your security camera, especially if the door was latched shut and there was no one home. What do you make of this one? The Tin Mine Ghost. South Wheal, Francis is a copper and tin mine to the south of Camborne in Cornwall in the UK. Parts of the mine go back to the 18th century, although its most profitable period was in the 1850s. When the copper was exhausted in the 1960s, it was replaced by tin from the nearby Great Flat Lode. Eventually, the mine closed in 1918. But today, the site still retains some of the original structures and is a World Heritage Site. However, as with many old mines, it's reputed to be haunted. The people who worked there endured awful conditions, and mining was a hazardous job. In the 18th and 19th centuries, it was commonplace for women and children to also be employed at the tin mines, although many above ground. But for the men who went down into the deep mines, conditions were hot, oppressive, and very dangerous, and not surprisingly, falls and death were commonplace. If they made it to the rock face, conditions were almost unbearable. Temperatures reached up to 16 degrees Celsius, and the air was polluted by dust and fumes from detonated explosives and could barely sustain a candle. In fact, some miners would choose to snub their candles out and work in complete darkness in order to conserve air. Tin miners were prone to many different diseases. Bronchitis, silicosis, TB, and rheumatism were all common complaints for miners, making life expectancy short, and few miners in the early days were fit to work beyond the age of 40. Fatalities were a frequent and unsurprising occurrence. So it's not surprising that some of the old tin miners of Cornwall were reported to be haunted by the former miners who worked and often died there in appalling conditions, and the old mines are a hotspot for paranormal activity and ghost hunters. So when a mother and daughter ghost hunting team, known as Cornish Ghost Whisperer, did a Facebook Live event at the site in August 2020, their 12,500 followers were in for a treat. They started their stream at around 10:20 p.m. It was very misty, as it often is in Cornwall, and this is what they filmed. You can see what looks like a figure of a man near the remains of an engine house. Some have pointed out that perhaps it's just a man stood there, but the team are adamant it was not a human, and there was something not normal about its distorted moves and the way it just vanished in front of them. Also, where he was standing was very high up and difficult to climb, with a sheer drop on one side, so it would have been hard for anyone to climb up there and then disappear without making a noise. The team believe they captured the spirit of one of the miners who used to work there. What do you think? Main apparition. As Chet Cook drove at night along a rural road in Falmouth near Maine, a mysterious shadow ran out in front of his car. At first he thought it was a deer, but when he looked over his dashcam footage, he was surprised to see it definitely was not a deer. Take a look. Cook was so disturbed by the creepy shadow that he sent the footage to 207 Paranormal, a local ghost hunting group, to see what they made of it. After the footage was shared online, some claimed it was a bear, deer, or big cat. However, some pointed out that the apparition was clearly transparent, ruling out anything living, and indicating the shadow was something far more sinister instead. Considering Maine is known for its paranormal activity, many tend to agree. What's your thoughts? The ghost of Edward II. Barclay Castle is a castle in the town of Barclay, Gloucestershire, in the UK. The impressive building dates back to the 11th century, and for the last 850 years has been inhabited by the Barclay family, and is the oldest inhabited castle in England. Over the years, the castle served an important role in English history, with its earls participating in many famous wars. And at one time, the castle was damaged after being battered by Lord Oliver Cromwell. The castle has a gruesome history, and visitors can still see a deep dungeon in the old keep, in which were once thrown the rotting carcasses of animals, accompanied every so often, it is said, by the corpses of common people who had offended the Lord. It wasn't just the locals who bore the wrath either. Over the years, various noblemen were captured and left to die unseen in the windowless cell that can still be seen adjacent to the dungeon. However, Barclay Castle is probably best known for the royal figure who was imprisoned and murdered there. In 1327, Edward II found himself confined to the windowless cell after he was deposed by his wife, Queen Isabella, and her lover, Roger Mortimer. It was their intention that a few days in the putrid cell would bring about his death. But he was made of stronger stuff, and although he became very ill, he didn't die, and clung to life in the cell for 5 months. His refusal to die meant the Queen instructed Edward's jailer, Sir John Matrelovers, and Sir Thomas Gurney to dispose of her husband as they saw fit. So on September 21st, 1327, Edward II suffered the most horrible death of any British monarch. The two men seized him and pinned him face down to the bed, whereupon a red-hot spit or poker was run up his backside into his bowels. Such was the king's agony that his screams were heard far beyond the castle walls. It is said, even today, on the anniversary of his death, those agonizing screams can still be heard echoing through the halls. It has long been believed that Berkeley Castle is haunted by the tortured soul of Edward II, as well as other unfortunate people who met their death there. So when in 2018, drone footage emerged that appeared to film an apparition in the courtyard of Berkeley Castle, it was believed to be the ghost of poor Edward. Take a look. The drone was being flown by Thomas Arnold, and he believes it shows a knight on horseback. And what is even stranger is at the point the footage was taken, he had lost contact with the drone and was forced to press the home button. When he looked through the footage later, he was shocked at what it showed. Could this be proof that Edward's spirit still lurks within the walls of the castle? What do you think? The Vending Machine Murders. In 1985, the Japanese company Otsuka Pharmaceutical was noticing a slump in sales of its health tonic drink, known as Aronomin C. To boost sales, they launched a campaign offering a free bottle of Aronomin C when purchasing a vending machine drink. As was typical with the Japanese, many of the unwanted free bottles would either remain in the slots or be placed on top of the vending machines for someone else to enjoy. Under normal circumstances, this would just be seen as a kind gesture. However, to a cruel, psychopathic killer, it presented the perfect opportunity to indiscriminately kill by poisoning. On April 30th, 1985, a 45-year-old truck driver from Fukuyama, Hiroshima, went to purchase a drink from a vending machine in the city when he spotted a bottle of Aronomin C on top of the machine, so he took that instead and drank it. Soon, after he fell seriously ill and displayed symptoms of severe poisoning and internal chemical burns, the medical staff could not do anything for him other than confirm the exact poison that was killing him. It was paraquat, a deadly chemical often used in weed killers that is banned in several countries due to its adverse effects on humans and animals, although in Japan it is readily available and is often used to commit suicide. Paraquat is so toxic that if it just touches human skin, it will cause blisters and quickly sinks deeper, burning blood vessel walls. If ingested, it is even more lethal and burns holes in the esophagus, inflames tissue around major blood vessels, and causes irreversible damage to internal organs. As little as a teaspoon of it nearly always results in death. A few weeks after drinking the poison, the Fukuyama man died an agonizing death, and a police investigation was launched. Then on September 11th, a 52-year-old man from Osaka suffered the same fate after drinking a free beverage from a vending machine. He died 3 days later. By the end of September, there were a further 3 deaths, all as a result of drinking Aronomin C. 4 more people died in October and 2 in November. All took free bottles, some from the top of the vending machine, but most from the depositing slot. A 17-year-old girl from Saitama, who died on November 24th, was the last victim. After that, the killings stopped as inexplicably as they started. The police worked hard to bring the person or persons responsible to justice, but they hit a brick wall. The poisoner was clever. They chose vending machines in obscure places that had no CCTV and few witnesses, and left no DNA traces. The 12 victims were killed indiscriminately in different locations with no connection between them, entirely at random. In fact, it looks like the randomness of the deaths was part of a sick game the murderer played, like a twisted version of Russian roulette. The only thing connecting the victims was that except for the last one, they were all male. With no evidence and no significant leads, the case went cold, and after 25 years, it passed the statute of limitation, a law that has since changed. There is now no chance of getting justice for the 12 innocent people who died horrific deaths from what could well have been a sick prank. The Glico Morinaga incident and the monster with 21 faces. You may have heard of Pocky, the chocolate-coated biscuit sticks in various flavors that originated in Japan that are now sold around the world. But what you might not be aware of is that the company that makes them, Azaki Glico, was once embroiled in an extortion and kidnapping case that cost them millions. At around 9 p.m. on March 18, 1984, Azaki Glico president, Katsushiya Azaki, was bathing his two young children when two masked men armed with a pistol and rifle entered his home. The intruders had stolen a key to his home from the next-door neighbor, who happened to be Katsushiya's 70-year-old mother, Yoshi. After entering Katsushiya's home, the men tied up his 35-year-old wife and his eldest daughter. Immediately, his daughter offered the men money, but it seemed that that was not their motive, and one of them responded by saying, "Be quiet, money is irrelevant." After cutting the telephone lines, the two men located Katsushiya in the bathroom, and after he put up a fight, they abducted him naked from his home and took him to a warehouse in Osaka. The next morning, they called the director of Azaki Glico and issued a ransom demand for 1 billion yen, about $4.2 million, and 100 kilograms in gold bullion. The director immediately informed the police. However, things didn't go to plan when on the 21st of March, Azaki managed to escape from the warehouse and raised the alarm. Thankfully, he was unharmed, but was unable to provide any information about his kidnappers, as they placed a bag over his head the entire time. But the extortion attempts against Glico did not end there. On April the 10th, vehicles in the parking lot of the company's headquarters were set on fire. Then on April 16th, a plastic container containing hydrochloric acid and a threatening letter to Glico were found in Ibaraki, demanding a one-off payment to end the harassment. Soon after the perpetrators started sending a series of taunting letters to Glico, the media and the police, the letters were signed off with the name, The Monster with 21 Faces, inspired from the villain of Edogawa Rampo's detective novels. Some of the letters claimed to have laced Glico candies with a potassium cyanide soda. Glico took the threat seriously and pulled its products off the shelves of shops and supermarkets. The move cost the company more than $21 million and resulted in 450 workers losing their jobs. But this wasn't the end of the incident. The monster threatened to place the tampered products back in stores, and following the threats, a man wearing a Yomiuri Giants baseball cap was caught on CCTV placing Geico chocolate on a store shelf. The footage was made public, but the letters kept coming. One of the letters received by the media and the police read, "Still, the police were no closer to catching the culprit. And after 3 months of trying, a letter was sent that read, and the company received no further correspondence from the monster with 21 faces. However, they then turned their extortion campaign to other food companies using much the same tactics. One of those companies was Madurai Ham, who, unlike Glico, agreed to pay the 50 million yen the monster was asking for to stop the harassment. A plan was agreed for Moradai employee to throw the ransom money onto a local train heading towards Kyoto when a white flag was displayed out of the train window. Instead of a Moradai employee, the police sent an undercover officer instead. But whilst travelling on the train to the drop-off point, the officer spotted a suspicious-looking man watching him. The man was described as a large, well-built man wearing sunglasses, his hair cut short and permed, with eyes like those of a fox. When the officer reached the drop-off point, the white flag was not displayed, so he followed the suspicious man from train to train. When he disembarked at Takatsuki Station, the fox-eyed man boarded a Kyoto-bound train and managed to escape the officers who were tailing him. But worse was to come. The monster sent a letter to the media addressing it to the mothers across Japan, threatening to lace Moringa confectionery products with cyanide. The letter caused mass panic in Japan, and this was worsened when products in shops were found with notes attached to them warning that they were poisoned with cyanide. And when tests came back, they confirmed some of the products were in fact poisoned. Moringa now seemed to be the focus of the monster's attention, and on November 1st, 1984, a letter arrived at the Tokyo home of the company's vice president. Morinaga responded to the criminals by placing the missing persons advertisement in the local newspaper morning edition. They were also forced to remove all their products from sale and reduce their production by 90%. But the monster wasn't done. Next, he started harassing the House Foods Corporation, and after weeks of threat, with the help of the police, the company agreed to pay the 100 million yen to the monster. This is when investigators took a second look at the fox-eyed man, but again, things did not go to plan. En route to the drop-off point, investigators spotted the fox-eyed man in a station wagon. They followed him as he headed to the drop-off point, where they had been instructed to drop the money in a can under a white piece of cloth. When they reached the drop point, the white cloth was there, but the can was missing. The stolen station wagon was later found abandoned. Inside the car was a radio receiver that had been eavesdropping on radio communications between the police officers involved in the drop-off. They also recovered a vacuum cleaner, although no fingerprint evidence could be retrieved from it or the car. Following the blackmail campaign, police released a facial composite of the fox-eyed man to the public. Quickly, suspicion fell on a man called Manabu Miyasaki. But despite him bearing a striking resemblance to the fox-eyed man, police checked his alibis and cleared him of any wrongdoing. Miyasaki later wrote a book about his experiences of being the number one suspect in the case. Although no one was poisoned as a result of the 21 Monsters extortion campaign, the perpetrators were responsible for one death. Shiga Prefecture Police Superintendent Yamamoto, who was in charge of the investigation, could take no more and killed himself in the most awful way by setting fire to himself. This seemed to prick the conscience of the monster, and 5 days later, on August 12, 1985, the monster with 21 faces sent its last message to the media. Following this message, the monster with 21 faces was never heard from again. Yamagami family disappearance. On June 4, 2001, 52-year-old Junko Yamagami was scheduled to take a business trip to Dalian, China, for the travel company she worked for. Before leaving, she was due to attend a meeting at her office, but by noon that day, Junko hadn't shown for her meeting or her flight, and her colleagues began to get worried. They checked her house, where she lived with her husband and mother-in-law, but nobody appeared to be home. The family dog and her husband's car was also missing. Soon after Yamagami's daughter, a 26-year-old schoolteacher named Chi, was also reported missing. Chi lived alone in an apartment in a nearby city, but it was known she had visited her parents the night before. A friend of hers confirmed that at 9:30 p.m., Chi picked up some makeup from a colleague and then headed for her parents' home in the small mountain town of Sera. The Yamagami's neighbors also confirmed they heard a car door close at around 10:50 p.m. What they heard was either from Chi's car or it was the sound of Yamagami's leaving. The family's newspaper delivery man reported that the car was missing when he came around 4 or 5 a.m. the next day. Authorities discover the Yamagami's front door was locked, but the back door was open. Nothing in the house appeared to be disturbed. The kitchen light was left on, all of their beds were made, and breakfast had been prepared. However, strangely, the Yamagami's pajamas were missing, and while their shoes had been left behind, their slippers were gone. Junko's luggage and the 150,000 yen she needed for her trip were also inside the house, as was her husband's pager. It seemed that the Yamagamis suddenly dropped whatever they were doing, took the family dog, and left the house in their pajamas and slippers. But the question was, why? A year into the investigation, the case seemed to be going nowhere. They had established that the Yamagamis had a good reputation and were not involved with shady or dangerous people. The husband, Masahiro, did have some money problems, but nothing serious enough to leave town. Then on September 7, 2002, police recovered a car that was found submerged in a reservoir. The car contained the bodies of the four Yamagamis and their dog, although strangely, no cause of death could be determined, and there was no signs of an attack or a struggle. The car was found in a neutral state, and Masahiro's window was down and the whole family was still strapped in their seats. The state of their clothing made it impossible to tell whether they were wearing their pajamas or slippers. Because Masahiro was in the driver's seat, police believed it was a murder-suicide or group suicide, although there seemed to be no evidence to support this, and what would be the reason? There was speculation that Junko was having an affair, and that it really was a suicide of some sort. Another idea is perhaps they were on the run from someone, or somebody forced them to leave, but who jumps in their car in their night clothes late at night and drives off for no apparent reason and ends up dead? 20 years on, the mysterious late-night trip and the deaths of the Yamagami family has never been solved. Subono Spa Incident. The Subono Spa Hotel, located in Uzu, closed in 1982 and was barricaded up and left abandoned. However, because it was reputed to be haunted, it became a magnet for explorers and ghost hunters. It is well known that the Japanese believe in hauntings and ghosts, and youngsters often explore haunted places as a test of courage, or kimodameshi as it's known in Japan. Kimodameshi is usually played in the summer by teenagers. At night, the youngsters visit scary places such as cemeteries, haunted houses, or dark forests to carry out specific missions to test their courage. On the 5th of May 1996, 19-year-old students, Ako and Biko, who lived in Himi City, Toyama Prefecture, told their families they were going to play kimodameshi at the abandoned spa. The two girls were classmates at the prefecture high school. And at the time, Ako was a company employee and Biko was a super clerk. At around 9 p.m, the girls set off in Biko's Subaru Vivivo car, and en route they stopped to buy batteries for their flashlights. They also stopped off at a nearby park, where they met some friends. At about 10 p.m. they left the park and headed to the hotel, and witnesses confirmed seeing the girls driving on National Highway No. 8 near the border between Toyama and Namrikawa City, just outside of Uzu City. When they reached the city, they again messaged friends and family to let them know their location. But no one knows if they actually made it to the hotel, as the girls and their car disappeared without a trace. Despite appeals and searches for the girls or their car, they've never been found. Many theories have been put forward over the years. Some believe the girls were lovers and ran away together to escape the wrath of their families, although there's not much evidence to support this. Another theory is that the girls were kidnapped by North Korea, a plausible explanation, as North Korea has a history of kidnapping Japanese citizens, something that we may talk about in a future video. Others believe they reached the hotel and were taken by the evil spirits that supposedly reside there. However, the most plausible explanation is that the girls ran off the road and are lying at the bottom of a lake somewhere. But where, nobody knows. What's your thoughts? Okiko doll. Now, we've covered some pretty creepy dolls on this channel, but we think the mystery of Okiko beats them all. In 1918, 17-year-old Akichi Suzuki was touring the Sapporo region of Japan for a maritime exhibition, when he noticed an enticing little doll in a shop window. Thinking it would be perfect for his 2-year-old sister, he used the last of his money to purchase the doll. She was exquisite, standing at around 40 centimeters. She was dressed in a traditional kimono and had raven black hair that was styled in a traditional okapa cut. Her eyes were a mesmerizing, glistening black color. When Suzuki gave the doll to his little sister, Kiku, she immediately fell in love with her and treated her like a little sister. She even named the doll Okiku, the same as herself. The pair were inseparable, and Okiku played every day with the doll and took it everywhere. The doll never left her side. Then a year later, tragedy struck. Yellow fever had descended on the community, and the little girl succumbed to the disease. Okiku died gasping for air, in pain, and afraid with the doll held firmly in her grasp. She was just 3 years old, and her devastated family wanted her buried with her favorite doll. However, circumstances and governmental oversight meant the doll was never laid to rest with Okiku. Instead, the family kept her on the family's altar, a common practice in certain Japanese households to commemorate the dead. And that is when things started to get strange. The family started to notice that the doll's hair was getting longer. Her once neat, traditional haircut was growing into a mangled mess of ends that reached down past her waist. It was scruffy, different colors, and felt odd. At night, they started to dream of Okiku, and sometimes the doll would appear by their side in the morning. The chilling events intensified and developed into full-blown acts of spiritual infestation. Lights flickered on and off. There were strange noises in the house, and odd voices were heard, especially around key dates like Okiko's birthday and the day of her death. Over time, they were convinced that their daughter's soul lived on within the doll. In 1938, the family relocated to a different neighborhood. They had by now become accustomed to Akiko, and had even grown fond of their daughter's restless spirit. To them, it was an opportunity to interact with their dead daughter. Because they wanted to keep that bond intact, instead of taking the doll to their new home, the family approached the local temple and asked them to take care of her so she could stay close to Akiko's grave. The priests happily accepted, and over time, they too confirmed the claims the family made about the doll. Significantly, that the hair does indeed grow. They even sent a sample of the hair for scientific analysis, and it was confirmed that the hair was that of a human child. As the years passed, the doll's frame grew and her powers developed, and she started invading the dreams of the priests and those that came to visit her. To this day, her hair continues to grow, and in the latest update, it's claimed that her mouth is slowly opening, and if you look closely, she has baby teeth growing. Akiko doll is located in a private shrine on display in a little wooden box in the Manamjin Temple in the town of Iwamizawa, Hokkaido, Japan, and she is available to visit if you dare. Uninvited wedding guest. This old photograph was sent in by a longtime viewer of the channel called Philip. The photograph is of his aunt Caroline's wedding service in the year 1984 at her local church in County Limerick, Ireland. It shows his aunt being walked down the aisle by her father, Philip's grandfather. But if you look in the top right window in the left pane, just above them, there appears to be an uninvited wedding guest. The photo was taken by Philip's great aunt Pauline, but no one noticed the anomaly until 2010. After seeing the figure, Aunt Caroline was so spooked she visited a medium, and they believed it was the spirit of Caroline's grandmother who passed away a few weeks before the wedding. She also had the photo and the original negative checked for any signs of tampering, but there was no explanation for the anomaly. Caroline has said she doesn't feel like it was a bad omen or anything. After all, it was the happiest day of her life, and she is still happily married all these years later. However, she has always felt like someone or something is watching over her. It's worth pointing out that at the time the photo was taken, the church had nothing outside those windows, and there was only a very small window still outside with a sheer drop below, and there were no bells, lamps, or lights that could cause a reflection. So what do you think it was? Creepy face in photo. Cindy lives in a small town in between Manchester and Liverpool called St. Helens, and this is the story of her experience growing up in her childhood home. It was a creepy house in an area known as Clockface, and it always had an uncomfortable vibe to it. Cindy experienced many odd things, including scratchings on the walls, her cat freaking out over nothing, as well as other unexplained phenomena. Before the family moved into the home, it belonged to an old man who had recently passed away. And as soon as they moved in, Cindy's parents could smell cigarette smoke coming from downstairs at odd times of the day when neither of them smoked, and they believed this was linked to the old man that lived there previously. However, one incident stood out and still scares Cindy to this day. It was the first time she was left alone in the house. She was excited but slightly paranoid. As she took a shower, she could hear laughing and keys jangling. Thinking it was her mum and brother trying to get in, she looked out the window but couldn't see her mother's car. So she got out of the shower and looked down over the banister. Cindy was shocked to see the keys to her front door on the floor. In a panic, Cindy locked herself in the living room and phoned her mum crying. Not long after, Cindy was laying on her bed and took a photo of herself. Her bedroom was directly above the living room with a connecting chimney breast. Cindy 100% believes there was something in the chimney breast, as all the strange activity seemed to happen near it. When she looked back at the photo, she noticed a creepy looking face on the wall next to her foot, which just happened to be the chimney breast. What do you think? Spawn Street Ghost. Medieval Spawn Street in Coventry, UK has a long history of paranormal activity. Over the years, businesses in the area have reported tales of strange knocking noises, being touched by unseen hands and mysterious footsteps, and on one occasion, one business owner found four of his sewing machines turning on and off by themselves. The Ostler's restaurant on the street also claims to have had regular visits from a ghost, which they named George, who was blamed for stock flying from shelves, glasses being smashed, and stones being thrown at customers. A witness at the restaurant also claimed to have seen the ghost of a woman at the top of a flight of stairs. Possibly the same apparition was spotted by Mr. Gibbons, who at the time was a miner at Coventry Colliery and also an amateur artist. He was exhibiting paintings of the 1984 and 1985 miner strike at the picture gallery at 167 Spawn Street, when he recalls seeing the figure of a woman come up the stairs to the gallery and turn at the top before disappearing through a wall. The description of the ghost matched that seen in Osler's restaurant. Later, the picture gallery was turned into an art supply shop, and the new owners all experienced stock moving and pictures being moved. The new owner claimed to know when the ghost was present because she could smell evening in Paris, a perfume popular in the first half of the century. After researching the story of Spawn Street, we were intrigued when Clark sent us this photo that his wife took about 3 years ago when she was photographing buildings for her university art project. Take a look. Clark's wife didn't see the figure in the photo until after she was looking back at them the day later. Nowadays, Spawn Street's old buildings have been remodeled, but reports of ghostly goings-on have still continued. So was this the apparition of a ghost, or is there another explanation? What do you think? Never dabble with the spirit world. This story was sent in by a viewer who wants to remain anonymous, so we'll call her Sue. In 2013, Sue lost her daughter after a full-term stillbirth. Understandably, she was absolutely distraught and desperate to know her daughter was okay and safe in the afterlife. Sue prayed for answers but could find no comfort. So she decided to try and contact a relative who had passed. Sue used various methods to try and contact the spirit world, including a spirit board, chanting and seances, and even offered up her own blood as a sacrifice. However, in her desperate quest to find answers about whether her daughter was okay and safe in heaven, she inadvertently invited evil into her life, and instead of getting the peace she sought after, her life turned into a nightmare that is still ongoing to this day. In 2016, after a year of terror, that included her clock always being struck at 3 a.m. in the morning, even with new batteries, unexplained knocking, photos being thrown, pictures coming off of her walls and ending up on the other side of the room, despite the hook still being in the wall, and sleep paralysis almost every other night, Sue also started being physically attacked. She was constantly being scratched, having her hair pulled, and being pushed. And even though she had recently moved, things hadn't gotten any better. Just take a look at this one photo of scratches she received. Sue is still terrified and doesn't know what she has invited into her life and wanted to share her story as a warning, not to dabble in the spirit world because nothing good will come of it. Box Hill Murder. A has always been extremely sensitive to the world of spirits, and back even before this incident, she had foreseen the death of her best friend. In 1992, A was a teenager, and like all teenagers, had an argument with her mum and left the house in a huff. She met up with her then boyfriend who had a car, and they decided to drive to Box Hill for peace and quiet. Box Hill is an area of outstanding beauty in North Downs in Surrey, UK. The drive there was fine, but after entering the Box Hill area, the weather started to change. Thunder clouds rolled above them, and to make matters worse, the car suddenly started to play up. They ended up pulling into a car park, where there was a pub to call for help. Within an hour, a man came out to look at the car, and couldn't find a problem, and the car seemed to spring back to life. So they continued to drive to a spot on Box Hill. Once they parked up, they started to talk about the weather, as the clouds were becoming darker and darker, and lightning started to streak the sky. During this time, A was aware clairvoyantly that her best friend came through spiritually smiling at her. She shook this off, and her then boyfriend started to kiss, when suddenly there was a bang on the side of the car. It made them both jump, and it sounded like someone was punching the side of the door. Freaked out, they decided they should drive somewhere else. And as they drove off, they both looked around to see if they could see anyone, but no one was there. As they drove to another spot, Thunder was clapping above their heads, with streaks of lightning coming closer and closer. By this point, A was completely freaked out and called on her best friend from the world of spirit to protect her, as she knew the banging on the door earlier was a bad omen. As she prayed clairvoyantly to the spirit world, she saw a man with dark hair who started to laugh at her and mock her for praying. He told her his name was Daniel, Danny for short. A then felt the sensation of being stabbed. Her boyfriend also said he was getting a strange sensation too, and admitted that every time he looked in his rearview mirror, he seen someone else's eyes in place of his own, and he wanted to murder her. At this point, they both decided to go back home, as things were getting too weird. Fast forward to 2003, A and her then husband experienced the same thudding on the roof of the car, just like in Box Hill all those years ago. A saw blood everywhere, and started seeing a person called Daniel and a rubbish bin. She brushed it off again. Then in late 2004, A's father's neighbor suddenly disappeared. Later, his body was found in Box Hill, and his name was Dennis Bates. A's dad told the police a strange man knocked on his door, saying that Dennis was in trouble and was laying low. The man was later arrested and charged with Dennis's murder. That man's name was Denny or Daniel Riley, and Dennis's body was found in rubbish bins. The Gurdon Light. The Gurdon Light is the name of a mysterious ball of light located near railway tracks off Interstate 30 in a wooded area of Gurdon, Arkansas. The light brings many curious spectators to the state each year, and although the railway tracks have now been partially covered or removed, the mystery continues. According to local legend, the light is a result of one of two ghosts haunting the area. In one story, it's believed that the light is from the lantern of an unidentified railway worker who was killed after falling into the path of an oncoming train. His head was separated from his body during the grisly accident and was never recovered, and as a result, his spirit continues to search for it, lantern in hand. The second story is based on real-life events. In 1931, railway foreman Will McLean was killed during a confrontation with one of his co-workers, a man named Louis McBride. What they argued about is unclear. Some versions of the story claim that they fought about the decrease in hours that McBride had been given due to the Great Depression. But most sources state the pair quarreled because McLean believed that McBride had tampered with a section of the tracks, causing a freight train with 14 cars to derail. Although it's widely believed that McBride had been trying to derail a passenger train. During the fight, McLean was reportedly beaten to death. Blood trails led to where his body lay, in a swampy area of the woods. McBride soon confessed to the murder and was executed via electric chair in 1932. The Gurdon Light is believed to be from Will McLean's lantern as he wanders the area, unable to rest. The light is described as either white-blue or sometimes orangish in color, and always sways back and forth, moving around the horizon. Although it was featured on Unsolved Mysteries in the 1990s, the program never determined the cause of the glow. Some believe it's a result of the lights from the highway reflecting through the trees, but it has been documented since before the highway was built. The first person to see it was reportedly a conductor who watched the glow follow the train for a mile before disappearing into a nearby graveyard. Others have postulated that the stress on the quartz crystal under the Gurdon caused them to emit electricity and produce the light. Those who have witnessed the light have also reported seeing a bluish mist, voices, shuffling sounds, and feelings of dread. The exact cause of the eerie glow is yet to be definitively established. The Devil's Footprints. Locals around X Estuary in South Devon were shocked one morning in February of 1855. At the time, the UK had been subjected to some of its coldest winters yet. Throughout the night and previous days, the townspeople had endured heavy snowfall, but this wasn't what surprised and concerned them. It was what happened in the snow overnight. Hoof-like tracks had been left in the snow and reportedly covered an area of between 40 and 100 miles. The prints were 4 inches in length, 5 inches across and between 8 and 16 inches apart. But instead of moving like, say, a horse would, with the right leg going forward and then the left leg, these marks, which were believed to have been created by a bipedal creature, went in a single file. Reports of the prints came in from around 30 different locations, and most bizarrely of all, were found in locations such as on top of houses, frozen rivers, high walls, and on drainage pipes. Stranger still, the impressions were said to have gone clear through the snow to the ground, as if they had been branded into it. It wasn't long before fear gripped the locals, dubbed the tracks of Satan or the devil's footprints, due to their resemblance to a cloven hoof. Some people thought that the devil was wandering around at night, searching for sinners, and refused to leave their houses after dark as a result. There has been much speculation about the origins of the so-called devil's footprints. Some investigators believe it was a hoax, while another, author Jeffrey Household, claims that they were the result of an experimental balloon, which had been mistakenly released. Apparently the balloon had had shackles attached to it, which had made the imprints, although it's curious that it never became stuck on trees or other objects. Supposedly, the balloon experiment was kept quiet because it had resulted in the damage of property. Another theory proposed by a reverend claimed it was possibly the result of a kangaroo, which had escaped from a private zoo. However, the reverend later admitted to making this story up as a way to distract his parishioners from the idea that the devil was walking among them. There is very little direct evidence concerning the devil's footprints. Most documentation comes from the findings of a collective of papers belonging to a local reverend in the 1850s. Skeptics admit that while some tracks can be explained by the likes of donkeys and ponies, others cannot. Curiously, in 2009, in North Devon, a woman found similar prints in her garden, reigniting the debate all over again. The ongoing mystery of the devil's footprints continues. The Bleeding House, Georgia. One of the most persistent mysteries in recent years is that of Georgia's Bleeding House. The home at the corner of Fountain Drive and Morris Street in southwest Atlanta had been rented by an elderly couple named Minnie and William Winston for over 2 decades. The couple had never once dealt with any supernatural experiences during their time there. That is until 1987. Late one night on September 8th, Minnie, 77 years old at the time, stepped out of her bath to find the floor of the room covered in speckles and droplets of blood. Alarmed and confused, she awoke her husband, 79-year-old William. Neither he nor Minnie bore any injuries, but the spots ranged from the size of a dime to the size of a silver dollar. The blood was found on the floor and lower walls throughout the home, in most of the rooms. It was also found in odd places, such as under the toaster and TV, and in barely accessible crawl spaces. It would be easy to dismiss this as the blood of an animal, but the elderly couple owned no pets, and there was no sign of rodent infestation in their rented accommodation. Local authorities were not immediately alarmed by the report they received from the couple the following morning, as William had a dialysis machine. However, the 79-year-old rejected the notion that he was responsible for all the blood found in the home. When the blood was tested, everyone was left stumped. It was not human, not animal, and was blood type O. The couple both had type A blood. There was no evidence in the house that a struggle had taken place or that a crime had been committed at all. The so-called Bleeding House prompted the elderly couple to be called and visited by curious townspeople at all hours of the day once the story broke. In recent years, the idea has been proposed that the couple were visited by an injured person, or possibly even a thief, and perhaps they never heard anything due to their old age. However, this wouldn't account for why the blood ended up in most of the house and under objects around the home. Many suspect that the whole thing was a hoax. Reportedly, the couple did not get on with their adult children, leaving some to believe that either the couple did it for attention from their children, or the children did it for financial gain. A reporter, who later conducted an interview with Minnie, claimed that she said it must have simply been a mix of rust and water. despite the fact that the police had proved otherwise with their testing. To this day, the case of the bleeding house goes unsolved. No further incidents of oozing blood in the property have ever been reported. The Phantom Sniper. In November of 1927, Camden, New Jersey was haunted by what is now known as the Phantom Sniper, who would open fire at random and leave behind not a single trace of their existence, not even bullets. The first known instance of the Phantom Sniper was when several cars and buses had their windshields shattered by what was at first thought to be bullets. Five vehicles in total were damaged. At first, the case seemed pretty straightforward. Someone had shot at the windscreens. However, upon closer inspection, the vehicles turned up no signs of bullet fragments or shell casings. Whatever had been used had simply disappeared. Luckily, during the chaos, no passengers were ever hurt by the bullets, although some suffered injuries from the broken glass. At some point during this initial investigation, a police officer was reportedly shot in the back and was left with massive bruising. Although he had been shot at twice, the first shot had missed him and dented the metal bridge he was walking along. According to some reports, the officer had been hit with a blue marble, which was recovered from the scene. Others, however, claim the marble was thought to belong to a copycat of the so-called Phantom Sniper. Attacks on vehicles in the area continued for the best part of a year, but no shooter was ever found, nor was there any evidence that he or she even existed. Witnesses never heard gunshots. Authorities often couldn't even locate good vantage points or determine where the shots had come from. The projectiles used to cause the damage were never discovered. At one point, it was believed that the sniper must have been using something such as a high-powered slingshot or airgun, but no such weapon was known to police at the time, and the damage often looked like it came from bullets. Meanwhile, other areas of New Jersey came under fire from similar attacks, but it's unknown if this was the work of the Phantom Sniper or another copycat. One story emerged from two women who had their bedroom window pierced and shattered at around 4:30 a.m. The victims claimed that a man ran from the scene with great speed and that he was the same man they'd seen loitering outside of their building earlier that day. In this specific case, a .32 caliber bullet was found, but it couldn't be deduced from where it was fired or even from what direction it came from. Once again, it's unknown if this was truly the work of the Phantom Sniper or not. The attack stopped suddenly in 1928 and never picked up again. The mystery of the Phantom Sniper remains unsolved. The Black Flash. Provincetown, Massachusetts became home to one of the most bizarre supernatural stories in the state's history in 1939. When a man-like creature dubbed the Black Flash began to terrorize the town's residents. The first report of the Black Flash came in October of that year, when a group of schoolchildren claimed that while walking home from school, an odd-looking creature jumped out from behind the dunes. They described it as 7 feet tall, fast, and dressed in black, and claimed that its laugh followed them all the way home. It also emanated a strange buzzing sound, resembling that of a bee or fly. Then, later that month, a woman named Maria Costa also ran into the strange entity. She had been walking past the town hall when it jumped out at her from behind the bushes. Mary described the Black Flash much like the boys did, but added that it had glowing blue eyes and silver ears, and noted that it could jump impossibly high. She ducked into a nearby coffee shop and relayed her story to some of the men there, who set out to track the creature down. However, they couldn't find it. At first, the local police department strongly believed that the Black Flash was simply a hoax being pulled by some bored young boys. But as reports concerning the creature continued to flood in and the townspeople grew more concerned, they began to have their doubts. Strangely, while reports were coming in from different parts of the town, several of these incidents were taking place at the same time. Soon the Black Flash became a well-known name in the town. It was also dubbed the Bolt, the Provincetown Phantom, and the Devil of the Dunes. As time went on, the stories about the creature grew bolder. Now it was no longer simply scaring the locals, but was instead starting to attack them. One teenager claimed that the creature could spew blue flames. According to one story, several men had managed to corner it, but it managed to leap the 10-foot fence and bullets did not pierce it. One man claimed that he shot it, point-blank with a shotgun, but it simply laughed in his face. The creature had become a symbol of terror in the town, and was later blamed for a string of fires, which caused $250,000 in property damage. The last reported sighting of the Black Flash was from a group of children who spotted it coming towards them in the fog. They ran home, locked the door, and were terrified when they heard it attempting to get into the house. One of the children had the idea to throw hot water on it, so they boiled the kettle, ran up the stairs, and poured the boiling water onto the creature from the second story of the house. Subsequently, the creature retreated and was never seen again. There have been many theories about what exactly the Black Flash was. Some have wondered if it was an athlete, while others, at the time, claimed that it was a gay man. Since it was the 1930s, alternative lifestyles were less widely accepted in the Western world than they are now. Many believe the creature must have been the result of a hoax. In the modern era, the Black Flash has been compared to Britain's own Spring-Heeled Jack, who wore a black cloak, had a silver face and red eyes, and who was capable of breathing blue flames and making high jumps. The Black Flash never returned to Provincetown, and essentially fell off the map after its escape from the children who threw boiling water on it. Whether it was a hoax, hysteria, or something more sinister, the legacy of the Black Flash is a chilling one nonetheless. Ghost, entity, or orb. This footage, uploaded to YouTube in July 2019, was captured in Chicago, near the site of a famously violent incident that occurred over 90 years ago. Northside resident Christopher Gerben noticed something strange on the feed from the doorbell camera situated to the rear of his apartment block. Overlooking secured windows and a staircase, an opaque orb can be seen moving up the stairs, drifting from the left-hand side to the right, before floating out of sight. Take a look. Cater News, who obtained and circulated this spooky recording, have disclosed that Christopher's apartment lies in close proximity to the scene of the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. On February 14, 1929, five members of the Northside Gang, run by George Bugs Moran and two known associates, were slain in a hail of machine gun fire. Though no one was convicted of the murders, the most obvious, and indeed popular theory, is that the assassination was plotted by rival mob boss Al Capone. So could it be that this mysterious floating entity is evidence of the spirit world? And if so, could it be related to the bloodbath that occurred on St. Valentine's Day all those years ago? Let us know what you think in the comments below. Heard but not seen. Now this is a strange one. In many instances, doorbell cameras offer images that may require some explanation, but this video instead offers us unlocated audio and the reaction of a very perplexed homeowner. Reddit user UnknownTrue7H posted two videos they claim were forwarded from a friend's Ring cam feed. On the first, we see a woman preparing her laundry in the morning when she hears a voice seemingly calling out to her. Take a listen. It does sound incredibly like a voice pleading, "Please, please, lady, please help me, please help me." In his post, UnknownTrue7H insists that although the woman heard the voice coming from behind her, it didn't seem to be emanating from the doorbell camera itself, which, if true, would eliminate the motion of the device being hacked. This lends an incredibly disturbing air to the whole incident. Though it could be a prank, either at the expense of the homeowners or by them, the follow-up video posted would seem to rule out any involvement by the owners, as you can see here.
I didn't see anybody out on the road or any cars or anything. So I went back to my Ring video to make sure I wasn't just courageously hearing something.
I can hear somebody saying something, but I can't...
Well, I posted it on there.
This short clip shows the woman was disturbed enough to call the police. And as we have seen, one of the responding officers also declares he hears the voice asking for help. As there are no further clips, nor any updates since this bizarre and troubling occurrence, we are left to wonder what actually transpired at this lady's house. Was someone genuinely in trouble? And if so, how could they have been so close, yet not seen by the homeowners? Could it be the case of auditory pareidolia, or was it all just a hoax? If you have any further details or theories about this incident, then do let us know. Woman with a knife. If your phone notified you of activity near your doorbell late at night, and this was the image that you were met with, it would certainly be enough to ensure a few sleepless nights afterwards. While in January 2020, a video was uploaded to multiple sites, again taken from a Ring cam feed. What it depicts, and the situation it could have led to, is both horrifying and sad. Take a look. To discover that someone, albeit an elderly woman, had been standing outside your home clutching a knife is the stuff of nightmares. Speculating about what could have occurred had the door been answered, with or without the occupant being forewarned by a doorbell camera, is terrifying. A range of theories about the strange behaviour exhibited by this woman has been put forth, including dementia and a reaction to medication. One poster, declaring themselves to be the original uploader of this footage, claims that this woman is mentally ill and was later returned to her care home by the police. We can only hope she is okay and that neither she nor anyone else came to any harm during this incident. Masked man covers camera. In what looks like a scene from a horror film, this next video depicts a man who has masked his identity and is acting in a most sinister fashion. Now, this material has been reposted many times, so you may well have already seen it, but the individual caught by this camera is just too menacing to exclude. The recording shows a man wearing casual clothing and a Halloween-style skeleton mask stride towards the property before he sticks masking tape over the doorbell camera, as you can see for yourself here. Without any sort of context, it's impossible to know just how ominous this conduct is. If it happens to be Halloween, then there may be less to be alarmed about, although it is most definitely not a treat, but if not, it's concerning to say the least. The most disconcerting aspect is the man's decision to cover the camera. Whilst the tape does peel back and there is no one in sight, the thought of what this individual could have been planning, or indeed what they were up to out of sight, is chilling. Mysterious light. In May 2018, footage depicting a large, strangely moving, glowing figure was posted online, spawning much debate and confounding viewers. This camera feed depicts a strange figure shining brightly, whilst transparent at the bottom. While many have decreed this vision is merely an insect crawling across the lens of the camera, the original poster insists that this, as yet unidentified form, is actually standing approximately 10 feet away from the camera. See what you think. As you can observe, at the end of the clip, this illuminated entity zooms away into the night sky with astounding speed. While some viewers are cynical and proclaim that there is a perfectly rational explanation for what this doorbell camera has captured, others are convinced that the entity seen is paranormal in nature. What do you make of it? Children's Immortality Project. Many of the sites associated with this bizarre occurrence, along with the images and comments posted on the 4chan spooky/paranormal board, are no longer available. However, the intrigue behind this strange concept and the man accountable for it lingers to this day. Over a decade ago, a thread on 4chan's X board appeared regarding a deluge of strange websites discovered by message board users that espouse the notion that children are created by their parents merely to be killed, and instead they should be enabled to harness never-ending life through a doctrine of international physical immortality. Within the huge number of sites discovered referring to children's immortality, other keywords such as taking over the internet and Google is my resume are seen repeatedly, as well as a name, Robert Ray Hedges. As the self-proclaimed most conscious person to ever live, it seems Hedges is the individual responsible for the outlandish belief that children are being denied immortality by their elders, and created an abundant number of links posting his theories. The style of writing and the appearance of the sites are as odd and disorientated as the ideas Hedges put forward. Many of the websites have been deleted, but some of the archived comments from 4chan members give insight into what they experienced after encountering Hedges' sites. One user explained that after providing a confirmational email address, they received bizarre and unexplainable emails, and that these scared them enough to prevent further investigation. Another user claims that it was really a deprived cult behind the site, and clicking on certain links would enable you to obtain membership. Though no evidence for such claims are offered, the posters do seem genuinely spooked out by Hedges' sites, which have been collectively dubbed the Children's Immortality Project, and they warn other curious posters to stay clear of them. The real purpose behind Hedges' content, and what has become of him now, is somewhat of a mystery, though the extent of the sites and the peculiar nature of them still prompt speculation. Yvette's Bridal Formal. Often described as a website from hell, Yvette's Bridal Formal gained wider public attention due to the discussion on Reddit threads and featuring in online articles as well as several YouTube videos. For the uninitiated, this site has become famed for its chaotic appearance, bewildering arrays of links, and for having relatively little useful information pertaining to buying or hiring Yvette's bridal and formal attire. The disorientated effect of the site is further enhanced by the music that plays on a selection of links. Yvette's website is no longer active, but as it has been archived on the Wayback Machine, it is still possible to observe the original format in all its colourful, frenzied glory. As you can see from the homepage, this site has an exceptional number of images and vivid hyperlinks. Though some do lead to business-related photos, they are not standard website format by any means, as can be observed on this page. The same photo of the business premises forms the background, with the addition of a selection of further shots, some of which bear little to no relevance to the shop, such as pictures of traffic, sunsets, and a bird on a fence. Others are presumably of the shop owner or manager, but they have a disquieting surveillance footage feel about them. They are taken at a distance and show a woman and her child as they arrive and depart the site, to the extent they are even shown getting into their vehicle. At the end of this page, images of a long-haired man can be found, and if you explore the site enough, you will discover that he also appears in further links and identifies himself as Sean Terrence Best, the individual responsible for designing the site. It is his artistic undertakings that feature so prominently on the site, as do his poems and musings on subjects such as travel, as well as an alleged encounter with writers from a UFO magazine. In this account, Sean also relates that there is a hidden code within the receipts he has posted on a vet site, but it isn't one he can decipher himself. A further example of the surreal and obscene content incorporated into this website. We could spend much longer discussing the unique appearance of a vet, which appears to have much more to do with the eccentricities of Sean than the business it purportedly represents. The site has prompted many questions over why it was designed in such a manner, with particular attention paid to the repetition of V8, which Sean has also written about elsewhere. It is this conspiracy theory that the code embedded in a vet's website alludes to. We'd love to hear from you if you have deciphered anything from this truly surreal site in the comments below. What happened to user Flip and Flop? For those of you familiar with Reddit, you'll know it appears to have a community for everything. So it's no surprise that one of the subreddits is r/drugs, where Redditors discuss the effects of illegal substances they have either taken or are thinking of trying. The subs about describes it as a risk reduction resource that promotes harm reduction and fights against the drug stigma. It's basically a community that looks out for each other whilst experimenting with drugs. While on April 17th, 2017, a post appeared from user, you flippin' flop, that read, "Finally got my hands on some Datura, how much should I take?" Many of the commenters were concerned and advised the poster that the only safe dose was none at all, whilst others shared their experiences and many warned against it. To give you a bit of background on Datura, it is definitely not something you want to mess with. Datura is a poisonous flowering plant known amongst other names as moonflower, Jimson weedweed, and Hal's bells. The seeds and flowers of the plant are especially deadly, and if ingested, can cause respiratory depression, fever, delirium, hallucinations, psychosis, and death. For centuries, Datura has been utilized in some cultures as a poison, and in some parts of Europe and India, it has even been used for suicide and murder. Modern users of the drug either ingest or smoke it for its hallucinogenic effects, and many tragic accidents have occurred as a result of young adults dying or becoming seriously ill from intentionally ingesting Datura. The onset of symptoms generally occurs around 30 to 60 minutes after eating or smoking the herb. These symptoms generally last from 24 to 48 hours, but have been reported in some cases to last up to 2 weeks or longer. The overwhelming majority of those who describe their use of Datura find their experiences extremely unpleasant, both mentally and physically, and those most seriously affected are often hospitalized and either have their stomachs pumped or are given drugs to reverse the effects, although sadly some do not make it. With all this in mind, when you Flip and Flop later added to his post by saying this, "I've crushed some seeds, around 15 to 16 in my mortar, and put them in a glass of hot water. I've added some lemon juice and sugar to mask the taste. I'll just have to roll my joint with the Datura leaves and I'll be set to go. I've decided that I'll be sipping on the tea and slowly smoking the leaves until I feel that the effect is strong enough." This caused immense concern amongst the community, with some sharing their horrific stories of taking the drug whilst others wished him luck. But when nothing was heard from the user over the next few hours, commenters started to get concerned. Then at 5:55 a.m. the next morning, Flip and Flop posted this. The comment caused even more concern, with many speculating things were not going well. Nothing was heard from for a further 12 hours, until Flip and Flop randomly dropped into the R Gaming sub and commented on the post, "Mammoths fighting in totally accurate battle," that showed a GIF featuring mammoths fighting. This comment caused more concern. That was the last anyone heard of Flip and Flop, causing the community to fear that they were dead. Despite pleas from users to get in touch and reassure them everything was okay, nothing has been heard of them since. Flip and Flop's disappearance has generated numerous searches for them on other forums without success, and the mystery of what happened to them rumbles on. Some have theorized that the post was created to cause drama and speculation, and the fact we are featuring the incident over 3 years later means they have achieved that. However, the Reddit community have been left worried, and if you search Reddit, there are still occasional posts from people asking what happened to Flip and Flop, with many fearing the worst. To date, we still do not know whether the whole thing was for effect or was actually real. What do you think? Padma G. McCord. Now there is a chance that you may have encountered this name before, as YouTubers Nexpo, Some Ordinary Gamers, and their channel VVVIOS have produced thought-provoking videos on this most peculiar mystery that are well worth a watch. Padma McCord has been the subject of much internet discussion due to the extraordinary number of search results attributed to her and the surreal nature of these entries. Many are promoting her as the president of Padma McCord Enterprise LLC, a Texas-based company which claims to deal in real estate and business investments. However, none of the sites or videos to do with her look right. For instance, she has a YouTube channel with 100 videos promoting her business, but they reveal absolutely nothing useful. Just take a look at some of these. As we can see at the end of the video, this content proclaims to be for SEO purposes only. By creating websites such as this, with a formal, professional-sounding address, one would assume the site would be full of helpful information, such as contact details, a biography, and a portfolio of her work. But considering many of her domains turn out to be banal, useless pages full of stock images and keywords, it has to be asked, why is she so concerned with promoting search results for her name? In what may be a coincidence, there does appear to be a family-owned real estate business in Houston called McCord, but there is no indication that Padma has any role here. Padma also has a saved playlist on her YouTube channel, which predominantly seems concerned with cyberbullying, harassment, and the regulation of social media. Combined with the fact that various videos about this mystery have been taken down, would suggest that Padma finds speculation about her posts by other YouTubers, sites and forums to perhaps fall into the category of harassment. Various posts online would indicate that Padma has employed a company named Digital Forensic Corp to convince some of these sites to remove the content that they've made about her. Indeed, it is this company that VVVIOS discusses in his video, where he converses with one of the firm's employees about Padma. No doubt some individuals have made distasteful comments about her online, possibly further fueled by another strange predilection she has, posting heavily edited and low-quality photoshopped images of herself, with a particular focus on changing her eye shape and color. In some cases, she superimposes her face onto a photo of a model in an advert. These images are plentiful, and many appear to include what we're led to believe is her husband and son, neither of whom seem to have any social media presence. To be honest, it's very easy to fall down the rabbit hole by looking into all the threads, domains, and photos associated with Padma McCord, not to mention the theory surrounding why this lady has chosen to make so much effort into promoting herself in such a very ineffectual and unusual manner. What do you think could be the reason for the approach she has taken? We'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments. The Indian Lake Project. This is a curious mystery that appeared between 2005 and 2013 on a blogspot, and to this day remains a topic of much conjecture. Part of this enigma-enduring appeal is due to the imitation of a CIA mind control project involving children, one which led to the most infamous Central Intelligence Agency's ventures, Project MKUltra. The individual writing the blog, who identifies himself as only John, details how his uncle discovered a metal box in 1997 whilst walking around Indian Lake in Hamilton County, New York. After John's uncle passed away in 2002, he came into possession of the box, which contained photographs, reels of 8mm film, and a variety of documents. The copious black and white photographs depicted military personnel, some of the buildings and facilities that he believed existed at Indian Lake in the 1950s, and some of children. Some of the photographs of children appear to show them as test subjects, identified by first only names and numbers. Troublingly, a few of the youngsters appear to be held in cages or cells, as they stare from behind bars. John supplements the found photos with some of his own after he visits Indian Lake and discovers abandoned buildings and an underground complex hidden deep in the woods, complete with odd bed frames that certainly look like they have been there for a long time. The contents of the box leads John to believe that Indian Lake was home to a highly classified base where mind control experiments were conducted on children, under the banner of Project Artichoke. The sinister intentions of this CIA operation can be observed in a memo from 1952 regarding Project Artichoke, which inquired, "Can we get control of an individual to the point where he will do our bidding against his will and even against fundamental laws of nature, such as self-preservation?" The operation saw subjects interrogated, hypnotized, and drugged in order to discover if they could be compelled to act as an assassin. Though no mention of minors in experiments has been mentioned officially in connection with Project Artichoke, which directly precedes the notorious Project MKUltra, but then would any government willingly acknowledge experimenting on young, vulnerable individuals in such a monstrous manner? It's worth noting that pupils at Willowbrook State School in New York, a large facility for children with an array of disabilities, were injected with hepatitis in order to observe the nature of the virus. This was rightfully described as the most unethical medical experiments ever performed on children in the United States. But it begs the question, what other equally disgraceful experiments have secretly been conducted on children? John's investigation takes some interesting turns. He is contacted by a woman he calls Mary, who confirms that her father worked at Indian Lake on the project, providing information corroborated by the documents in John's possession. But after a while, he begins to distrust her declarations of wishing to aid him in his quest to discover the truth, after Mary requests for him to send her the original photos of the children he has. John halts contact with Mary and refuses to publish any of the documents he has. He also writes that his house has been broken into, but nothing has been taken, and he starts to receive menacingly silent phone calls multiple times per day. The last blog entry is on February 25th, 2013, and despite providing a Twitter link, on which he posts the next day, promising new information to follow, he never posts again, leaving us all to wonder if there were ominous consequences to his revelations about Indian Lake. Or was this just a detailed hoax or art project? What do you think? Trevon Wynne. On Saturday, April 23rd, 2011, Trevon Wynne, a 24-year-old father of one, was gunned down, execution style, on a Brooklyn street. The Red Hill, South Carolina resident was in Brooklyn visiting his aunt at the time of his murder. At around 7:40 p.m., Trevon was chatting on the phone outside his uncle's Crown Fried Chicken store at 2085 Nostrand Avenue in East Flatbush when he was approached by a stranger. Moments later, the assailant pulls out a gun and repeatedly shoots Trevon at close range. The whole shocking incident was caught on surveillance video. Take a look. Moments before the shooting, the camera catches the suspect walking inside the store. Watch as he appears to move the gun from his waistband to his jacket pocket in preparation for the assassination. After the shooting, as Trevon attempts to get to his feet before collapsing on the pavement, a second CCTV camera catches his murderer fleeing the scene. Trevon was rushed to Kings County Hospital Center, but was later pronounced dead. It was apparent from the start of the investigation that potential witnesses to the shooting were reluctant to come forward for fear of retaliation. The area is a tough place to live, and one longtime resident dubbed the street where Trevon was killed as Body a Week Avenue. The only thing that is known is that the gun that killed Trevon was a large caliber handgun, but apart from that, little progress has been made and there have been no arrests. Trevon's family are convinced he was killed by a perpetrator who mistook him for someone else. They admitted that Trevon had a criminal record, including several arrests in South Carolina, but he had been trying to turn his life around and was not involved in gangs. However, his partner, who was expecting their second child at the time of the shooting, had a different opinion. She is quoted as saying, "In my heart of hearts, I know it's not mistaken identity." Whatever the reason for his murder, Trevon Wynn was a young father with his whole life ahead of him. The Cowboy Boot Robber. On September 19, 1987, a well-dressed man entered a bank in Spokane, Washington, and pulled a gun on the teller. He then announced that he was holding up the bank and produced a police scanner, claiming that if anyone tried to alert the police, he would know. The man then escorted everyone who was in the bank into the vault and forced the terrified teller to empty the cash drawers until she had handed over $100,000. The robbery was over in under 5 minutes, and no one was physically hurt. The perpetrator then fled the bank, leaving no prints behind, and also managed to avoid being captured on CCTV. Bank employees and witnesses to the heist reported that the man appeared calm and well prepared. The only distinguished thing about him was his cowboy boots. Almost a year later, on August 30th, 1988, the thief struck again when he stole $14,000 from another bank in the same area. This time, a dye pack was placed in the bag along with the cash, and it went off after the robber made his escape. This caused quite a commotion on the street, and at least one witness saw the offender enter a vehicle before fleeing the scene, but unfortunately, the vehicle was never tracked. Fast forward 3 months, and another bank was held up. This time, bank employees got a good enough look at the robber to help make a composite sketch. However, the sketch didn't provoke any leads. Then on June 6, 1989, the thief attempted to rob Spokane's Horizon Federal Credit Union. This time, however, he was challenged by the employees, who tried to stop his robbery attempt. Despite their brave efforts, the perpetrator still managed to steal money from the vault and ordered the tellers to empty their drawers. However, one quick-thinking staff member pulled money from the bill trap in the drawer, which activated both the silent alarm and the CCTV cameras, and for the first time, the robber was caught on film. This new image of the thief allowed authorities to link him to at least 3 robberies in Tucson, Arizona. In April of 1990, he robbed a bank in Washington and then struck again a few years later in June 1992. On those occasions, he showed his gun and warned the bank staff not to trigger any alarms. After retrieving the money, he ordered the employees into the vault so that they couldn't see his getaway. The man, dubbed the Cowboy Boot Robber, is suspected of committing at least 9 robberies of banks in Spokane and nearby areas. It is unknown exactly how much he got away with, but to this day he has never been caught. At the time of the robberies, he was described as between 35 and 45 years old and around 6 foot tall, weighing 200 to 220 pounds, with a tanned complexion. It is believed that he lived somewhere in the southwest US and commuted to the Pacific Northwest. Today, he would be in his 60s or 70s, and most likely retired and living off his ill-gotten gains. Mary Ann Fowler. On Christmas Eve of 2002, in Port Allen, Louisiana, 65-year-old Mary Ann Fowler wasn't carrying out the usual holiday traditions that one might expect. Her husband Jerry was in prison, and she was on her way to pay him a visit. Jerry Fowler was a former Louisiana elections commissioner who was serving 5 years behind bars in a Texas federal prison for bribery. He had resigned a few years earlier in 1999 and pled guilty to receiving kickbacks from voting machine contractors. While on her way to visiting her husband, Mary decided to stop for something to eat. so she pulled into the parking lot of a strip mall on Louisiana Highway 415 west of Port Allen, where she headed into a Subway sandwich shop. She exited the store between 5:30 and 5:40 p.m., but never made it to see her husband. Sometime later, a Subway employee saw that her Mazda was still in the parking lot. As she looked closer, she realized all her belongings were scattered over the pavement, including several acrylic nails. When authorities arrived on the scene, they determined that robbery was not likely the motive, as Mary's car keys and purse had been left behind. They also found wrapped Christmas gifts on the back seat of her car, but they do believe the acrylic nails found were torn off in a violent struggle. Investigators managed to recover CCTV images from inside a liquor store two doors down. The surveillance footage showed a dark-colored 1994 or 1995 Chevrolet pickup truck parked next to Mary's car, and upon closer inspection showed a man walking up behind the 65-year-old and grabbing her. The camera panned away for a moment before turning back, showing the same man climbing into his pickup truck and speeding off. Tire tracks found in the parking lot were thought to be from the abduction vehicle. This is the grainy image recovered. Despite the fact that authorities had managed to capture the abduction of Mary on camera, the footage was unfortunately not clear enough for them to be able to identify the suspect. They were also unable to get a license plate number from the abduction vehicle. The lawyers of Jerry Fowler attempted to get him furloughed so that he could assist in the search for his wife, but were unsuccessful. He died in 2009 without any answers. Authorities later ruled out a connection between the disappearance of Mary and her husband's criminal activities. And the prime suspect in the vanishing was Derek Todd Lee, also known as the Baton Rouge serial killer, who operated in the Baton Rouge area of Louisiana between 1992 and 2003, where he killed 7 women. At the time of Mary's disappearance, Lee had a truck similar to the one seen in the strip mall parking lot next to her Mazda, and sold it just days later after law enforcement announced that they were looking for the vehicle. Call records placed him nearby when she vanished, and Lee had no alibi for that time period either. However, DNA has failed to link Lee to Mary's case. Here he is during his 2004 trial. Lee was considered a suspect in several different missing person cases and died in 2016 of heart disease whilst on death row awaiting execution, possibly taking the fate of Mary to his grave. Leah Rowlands. On March 10th, 1997, 41-year-old Leah Rowlands was working in the Cozad Amoco gas station on Highway 80 in Dawson County, Nebraska. She had been promoted to store manager just one day prior and was described by family friends as a generous and outgoing woman who was also a divorced mother of two. At 10:30 a.m., a 1993 red Pontiac Grand Am pulled into the gas station. The male driver filled the tank and then entered the store barefoot. He moved to the back of the shop as he waited for the customers at the till to leave, and while he did so, he picked up a fizzy drink, opened it, and took a sip as he looked right into the CCTV camera. When the mother and daughter at the till left, the man walked right up to the counter and demanded cash from Leah, who complied and handed him the money. He then instructed her to lie on the floor. A few minutes later, the man leaned over the counter and shot Leah 3 times before he fled the scene. Leah was shot 2 times in the arm and 1 time in the head. She died instantly. The whole shocking incident was caught on CCTV, and police later released images of the suspect and his car. Despite numerous appeals, the suspect has never been identified. He is described as being a white male with dark hair, but the footage was too grainy for authorities to be able to make out the license plate number on his car. He also left behind a full handprint. The 9mm bullets fired from the handgun were never linked to any other crimes, and police thought that robbery was possibly the motive. The perpetrator made off with 1 half-empty bottle of fizzy juice, 1 packet of cigarettes, a lighter, a full tank of gas, and $150. There have been very few tips in the case, even though America's Most Wanted aired a segment on it and included the CCTV footage. There are a few theories, though. One suggests that Leah was simply in the wrong place at the wrong time, that the shooting was a random theft and murder, likely committed by a passerby. Police believed, however, that this wasn't the perpetrator's first or last murder, as he appeared confident and calm while carrying out his actions. A second theory was suggested by Leah's brother, Roy. He believed that her ex-husband had hired someone to dispose of Leah due to the ugly nature of their divorce. Reportedly, Leah had not only gained custody of the couple's two sons, but she had also managed to obtain a large sum of money as well. Several years before she was killed, Leah had written a 16-page letter to her sons explaining why she left their father, in which she detailed years of abuse and fear. However, Leah's ex-husband was never officially considered a suspect and died in 2015. To date, the handprint has never been matched to other crimes or any databases. Daniel Vella. On March 26, 2011, at around 9:45 p.m., 40-year-old tattoo artist Daniel Vella was tattooing a client in the Pretty Ink Tattoo Parlor in Sydney, Australia. Two hooded men wearing pink washing-up gloves walked into the shop from a back door. One of the men walked over to Daniel and shot him point-blank. After the shooting, the perpetrator inexplicably shot four times into the walls and ceiling before walking out the door he came in through. The bullet entered Daniel's shoulder and travelled down to his abdomen, causing extensive injuries. After being shot, 40-year-old Daniel staggered onto Victoria Street with his arm wrapped in a t-shirt. When paramedics arrived on the scene, he was able to tell them what happened, but sadly died on his way to hospital. There were at least three witnesses to the crime, and CCTV caught the killer and his companion from the moment they walked the shop's rear entrance to the moment they left after shooting him, although police only released 10 seconds of the footage. Here it is. Despite this video evidence, no charges have ever been brought in Daniel's case. Apart from the CCTV footage, the perpetrators didn't leave any trace and ballistics couldn't link the murder weapon to any other crimes. Daniel had no known enemies, criminal links or disputes. He did have a small criminal history, but that was from his days as a much younger man. Police were left baffled as to why anyone would wish harm to the 40-year-old artist. 2 years after the killing, authorities suggested that Daniel wasn't specifically targeted, but that he was possibly the subject of a random attempt at intimidation. Daniel drove a motorbike, but he was not affiliated with any gangs and was known to despise the influence that biker gangs had in the tattoo industry. And because one of the tattoo parlor's owners was a member of the Hell's Angels, Daniel was planning to leave the parlor to join a shop that had no links to bike gangs. Three suspects were eventually identified, all of whom had connections to bike gangs, but authorities did not have enough evidence to lay charges. There have been several theories surrounding Daniel's case, one being that the shooting was part of an intimidation ritual, and that someone was trying to show their allegiance to a certain gang, or that he was shot in an attempt to send a message to the owners of the parlor. In 2016, a prime suspect was identified, who was a member of the Hell's Angels biker gang. Allegedly, the suspect disappeared for a few months after the shooting, but cannot be publicly identified due to a court order. Authorities believe this person is linked because they received two separate tips regarding them. Police have also revealed that the suspect has a long string of violence, gang affiliations, and is a similar build to the person seen on CCTV. However, that same year, the suspect was facing deportation, and updates on Daniel's case have been few and far between since.